working live as the sun is setting in Brampton, Ontario. It's a Saturday night. It is Boxfest 5, a five-card event here at the Red Owl Performance Center in the Owl's Nest tonight, and welcoming you inside, everybody. Hello, boxing fans around the world. Rod Black with you, along with my great old friend, not old at least, Stevie Molitor. The champ is inside the building. And Stevie, a few years ago, used to call your fights on a Saturday night. There is nothing like a Saturday night, no matter where it is, watching fights.
There isn't, and I had the same feeling calling the fights here at Red Owl that I did when I was fighting at Casino Rama. The energy is just always so uplifting here. Everyone's excited to see a great night of fights, and they always have a good card from top to bottom. And we have another one here tonight.
Champ, you are looking so good, too. Look
Thank
at this.
You so
oh,
much.
My gosh.
I do my best.
Let's take a look at the five-card fight tonight. What interests you the most? We're going to see Carlos Nava from Texas. It is a Texas takeover tonight. There is a Texas theme. We'll get into that in a second. But what fight are you looking forward to most?
The PG Tondo versus Eder Clervoix. I've seen them both fight. PG's fought here before. PG's been in the battle with my friend Evan Gillard. They're both fighting, I feel, for the position to be the man here at Red Owl in that weight division. So that's the fight I'm looking to most of the whole night.
I'm so looking forward to this. This is my first Owl's Nest cover tonight. What can I expect? There is a buzz in this building. You've been in the previous four.
They just have such a great atmosphere here. They promote it well. There's a lot of athletes that train here throughout. It's such a great facility. Like we mentioned earlier, and we'll talk about later, the facility they mentioned, they've opened up in Houston, Texas, along with other gyms throughout Ontario. But Houston is the biggest and newest facility that they've opened up. So, I mean, they have a lot of big things in the works.
Let's talk about Texas. Tonight is a Texas theme. I guess we'll have to wear cowboy hats at some point. But it's a Texas takeover tonight. And recently, Red Owl South, promoted a fight in Houston, Texas. By the way, a great area for fighting.
It is great. I fought at the World Championships as an amateur in 1999 in Houston, Texas. But everything is so much bigger in the States when it comes to boxing. So it's just such a great thing for Gabe and the Red Owl brand that they've reached out. And they're going to have a fight series. And they're getting things rolling down there in Houston, Texas. And it's only going to make this brand bigger than it possibly could ever be.
And we've got a Texan on the headliner tonight, Carlos Nava. We'll talk about him a little bit later. But yes, Texas, it's always big in Texas, and we've got lots to talk about Texas tonight. We're going to wear our cowboy hats, I guess, a little later, but you mentioned Gabriel Fanous, the Red Owl president. He's talking about promoting fighting and making it bigger deep in the heart of Texas.
I think one of the main things that we talked about, too, is does this solve a problem?
Yeah.
I don't think no one has went over and beyond and gave fighters a consistent schedule to fight on for as long as we're talking about doing it. That fighters, trainers, and managers all alike are going to fall in love with that piece right there. So as we flesh this thing out and we turn it from concept to reality, I think a lot of heads are going to turn and people are just going to be naturally drawn to it because it's consistent.
If we use Houston as a case study and prove that it can work there with new incentive structure, new organizational structure, consistency in fights, everybody cooperating together, we wanna structure it the same way that every other sport operates. That's it, you know? There's no magic sauce. It's just like, let's build this better.
Houston, we've got no problem. We've got no problem in Brampton tonight. Stevie, I'm stoked, I'm pumped, I'm excited. Can't wait for this. Here is ring announcer Dave Needman.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening and welcome to the Owl's Nest here in beautiful Brampton, Ontario, Canada. For an evening of top flight professional prize fighting, this is Boxfest at the Owl's Nest.
This is sponsored by Aero Facility Management, the Aero Group of Companies, Remy Martin Cognac, and the Zaman. And all our partners this evening are sanctioned by the Ontario Athletic Commission, Commissioner of Riverside, Nawid. Our timekeeper throughout the night is Jim and Uncle Bond, and medical supervision provided by Riverside by Doctors Omar Chahari and Dr. Rosanna Tassoni.
Thank you.
the return of rising junior welterweight star Carlos Nava. And without further ado, the action starts right now. Making his way down to the ring, please welcome Marlon Perez Juarez.
Mi nombre es Marlon Perez, La Roca. Yo soy de la Ciudad de México. Pues mi historia fue en la calle principalmente, ¿no? Y a través de todo el tiempo me sacó de las drogas, de las malas amistades y sigo aquí. Amo la adrenalina, esa sustancia que te da a pelear en vez de una droga. Pero los golpes se da, la adrenalina. Llegar a ser alguien en la vida, un campeón.
Now about to make his way down to the squared circle. A warm welcome, please, for Nawid Zaman.
My name is Nawid Zaman, and I'm a pro boxer as a 1-0. I was feeling super calm, and I know it might sound psychotic, but I thought to myself in the mirror, I know myself pretty well, what to expect for myself. Straightforward when they're taking care of business. Those gloves nice and tight, so I felt the skin, you know, into my gloves, so it was good. Found is number one for me, yeah, for sure, yeah. And then I want to show them, like, everything's possible if you put the hard work. And it's all dedication and hard work, you know? Nothing comes easy. My condition's good. We've been training with Coach Billy, and obviously, like, this guy put in a lot of work, and he knows how to take care of business. Yeah.
Nawid. I dreamed I'm in my moment. Nawid has a lot of fans, friends, and family, a lot of signs. He makes his return to the Owl's Nest tonight, Steve Molitor.
I called his last fight his amateur debut. He's under my former coach, Billy Martin. So I know Billy is teaching him the discipline and the basics of boxing. I know that they're getting the road work in. So I know that Nawid Zaman is gonna come in here better than he was last time.
Nawid Zaman, what a great story. Comes into the game a little bit older than most fighters would, making their pro debut not long ago. 34 years old. Father Time's clock is ticking. Nawid comes by us here. Here he is, and he's an impressive fighter for a guy who's got a late start.
He's very impressive, and his will and determination in the gym is what's making him a better fighter. I mean, he's very strict in the gym. I talk to Billy Martin regularly, so I'm excited to see what he happens here tonight at his second trip to the Owl's Nest.
All right, fight fans, it's time for the opening bout of the evening. This contest is brought to you by Red Owl Boxing and is scheduled for 4 rounds or less in the super middleweight division. Sponsored by DAZN, our judges for the contest are Eric Marlinsky, Mark Simmons, and Martin Dalida. And once the action begins, the referee in charge, Donovan Boucher. Introducing first, on my left, fighting out of the blue corner, and tonight wearing white, red, and green. He weighed in officially at 170 pounds even. He enters the ring with a record of 1 win against 2 defeats with 1 knockout. Hailing from Mexico City, Mexico, ladies and gentlemen, introducing Marlon La Roca Perez Juarez. And and his opponent on my right, fighting out of the red corner and tonight wearing black trimmed with gold. He weighed in officially at 168 pounds. He enters the ring with a record of one win against no defeat, one knockout, fighting out of Toronto, Ontario. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Nawid Zaman. Once again, referee Donovan Boucher.
Okay, gentlemen, I'm expecting a good, clean fight. Listen to my command at all times. Most importantly, protect yourself at all times. Anything above here is good. Anything above here is good. Touch glove, good luck to both of you.
Former Canadian welterweight champion Donovan Boucher in the ring as a referee now. Away we go. This is bout number one of our five-carder tonight. Nawid Zaman, black and gold trunks. Marlon, Perez, Juarez in the white trunks. Super middleweight, four rounds here to start it off tonight on this Saturday night in Brampton.
Move to your right, come on. Away from that, away.
And Nawid is new to the pro ranks. Fought a lot as an amateur. Looked impressive in his last outing here. Oh, and he looks impressive now here.
And I think he touched the knee there, Juarez, and Boucher didn't call it.
Up. Throwing him here. This might not go long if Nawid Zaman can continue with that flurry.
And Zaman's got to do it. What made it happen in the first place. He kept the distance and used that reach to keep Juarez at the end of the punch, and that's what put him on the seat on his knee there.
Nawid Zaman, who normally day-to-day works as a pizza guy, owns a pizza store downtown Waterfront Toronto, trying to set up for some good delivery here tonight.
And you know, that's part of being a professional boxer in Ontario. It's not as glitz and glamorous as you think as the Floyd Mayweathers and Manny Pacquiao's. A lot of the fighters got to have jobs and work, but Zaman's a hard worker. Like I said earlier, I talked to Billy Martin. He's in the gym every day. He's still going to work and going to the gym every day. So that shows his heart and determination to advance his career here in the professional ranks.
Find that range, there you go.
Zaman, early on here, seems to be taking his game plan to Perez Suarez.
Watch that right, you know what's coming.
And the key so far, Rod, has been the key of the fight has been the jab of Zaman. It has kept everything at a pace that he can control. He keeps the distance, he keeps the pace, and Juarez just doesn't have an answer for that jab.
Jab again, missing here. Perez Juarez. He has fought here at the Owl's Nest. Look out now, again, a big uppercut. Again, and now the Mexican fighter rallies back. Late in round one of four, super middleweight here tonight. Bout number one of our Boxfest 5.
You know he's just coming over top every time. Get that stick going, feint.
Zaman coming off a win in May over another Mexican fighter, a third round KO over Miguel Mendoza Melquiades. La Roca, the Rock, has predicted that he will knock out Zaman with a body shot, he said, in round two. He's going to have to do a lot more than this here tonight.
He is, but Zaman's got to be careful because he just ringed a hard, hard shot, Juarez did. He's still got some power left in him, and he's not to be taken lightly. Zaman can't get reckless and just think that it's going to be a cakewalk. He has to use that jab and follow with the right hand.
Let's get in the corner here with trying to coach Billy Martin with Nawid Zaman.
Billy Martin's one of the greatest coaches in the country right now, Rod. He was a coach at the end of my career. He's one of the coaches that puts in full time. Here we see some of the action, some good work by Zaman. See, Zawan's gonna have a tough time when he's too close to Juarez. He's gotta keep that distance and use the reach to his advantage. That's gonna be the biggest difference maker here tonight.
So this is where Marlon Perez Juarez, who won his pro debut in Mexico but has lost his two matches in Canada, says he loves to trade punches.
And I'm sure he does, Rob. Being in the gyms in Mexico myself previously, that's what these guys do. They just spar and go to war. So it's best for Zawan to stay on the outside and box and not get into an exchange, because that's a comfortable place for Juarez.
Weed from Toronto. Early on in round two, scheduled four here tonight, as fans filing in here at the Owl's Nest, Red Owl Performance Center. Now Perez Juarez, a little different tact here in round two.
But in the last 30 seconds, Rod, just the jab of Zaman is just so impressive in comparison to his last fight. He's just popping with so much nice flow, so much accuracy, and just an overall nice snap, where I feel in his pro debut, he was kind of just lagging a little bit.
Taller fighter, more reach, obviously. Mexican fighter lowers his gloves and trying to bait Zaman a little bit here.
And that's a trap that Zaman doesn't want to enter into, because like I mentioned earlier, Juarez is ready for that. He's ready to throw a big, big, hard shot if Zaman gets reckless and walks in without throwing that jab first.
Great boxing nation. Oh, look out, he caught him. Uh-oh, Perez Juarez goes down here in round two.
It all started with a good stiff jab followed by a short right hand.
Nawid Zaman, the shot here. You said it, the jab that sets up everything.
There's lots of time here left in the second round. And here's where he's gonna gain experience, Rod. He's gotta be patient and not get wild and rush in. He's gotta remember what got him here by sticking behind that jab.
Overhand right is a weapon for Zaman. So many friends here, a lot of people rallying for him. Said age is just a number. Doesn't care about his birth certificate, the fact that he's started late. Started late, like to end this early.
Well, he's really working away, and that jab has been a key. But another, and a beautiful right uppercut to the body.
Perez Juarez fighting back now, too. Great nation, boxing nation, Mexico. So many fighters who been scrapping around the world. Many fought in Canada. And that's round two. So Marlon Perez Juarez hits the canvas thanks to Nawid Zaman.
No hay que jugar, hay que hacer las cosas serio. Tranquilo. Hay que tirar un poquito más de golpe. Está tirando ese jab muy lento, muy lento.
Vamos
a tirar un poquito más rápido. Tirarlo doble.
But Zaman was landing some good hard clean shots, and Juarez definitely was hurt to the extent we're not sure.
De un upper con esa misma izquierda, pero es que sabes que cuando entras te le pegas, no te le pegas porque de pegado no puedes tirar golpes. Tienes que tener su distancia.
Listening to his coach, and here we go, round three, scheduled four here at Owl's Nest tonight. Nawid Zaman made his pro debut here at the Owl's Nest, and look at Perez Juarez coming forward in round three.
Well, I'm sure his corner told him that he's down with a knockdown. He has no chance to win this fight unless it's by a knockout, so he's got to apply some pressure and hope that the man makes a mistake.
Clutch here, Donovan Boucher again. Longtime Canadian fighter. Oh, and now Perez Juarez wants to engage. It was in round three that Zaman ended his last fight here at Owl's Nest against a Mexican fighter.
And that was a good switch off the ropes from Zaman, because that's where right where Juarez wants him, is on the ropes or in the corner. So Zaman was smart and quick to spin off those ropes.
Canadian fighter. The Mexican fighter here tonight in our first contest of schedule five tonight.
And you can hear Coach Billy Martin say, circle to your right, circle to your right. And he's been doing it since the first round, because the only real threat that Juarez is shown tonight is that overhand right. So when Naman moves to the right, he's out of danger. But when he stands there, he's in line to get hit with that wild overhand right from Juarez.
Veteran of many fights, a lot of amateur, but not in the pro ranks. And only one fight against a Mexican fighter. We've known through the years, you fought a lot of Mexican fighters through years. You know how their game plan works.
They're tough, and they're not here to lose, and you can never take them for granted for 1 second, no matter how much damage you've done first, second, third round. They will fight to the bitter end, so you always got to be on point and ready to do anything.
Love the cat and mouse game, too. They will play possum.
They'll play possum. They'll play hurt. They won't do nothing for five or six rounds, and they'll throw nothing but hard shots for the seventh and eighth round.
Oh, there's that hard jab followed by the right again from Zaman. Oh, and a roundhouse right that time from Perez Juarez. Here comes Zaman once more.
Zaman doing a good job of keeping the distance after he's landing those shots, because that's when Juarez is swinging and that's when he's dangerous. But a very good job by Zaman and by getting out of there with his chin down and hands up.
Was in the latter stages of round three when he ended his last fight here at the Red Owl Performance Center, and it was around this time. A lightning strike twice. Final 20 seconds, round three. Zaman looking to tee off here.
But he's got to be careful when he's whipping that big right hand out, that he brings his left hand back up, because Juarez is looking to land that overhand right.
Like that. Bell's going to ring. Oh, he caught him there. Flush. Nice right hand. So far, it's really been Nawid Zaman who has owned this fight as we head to the final round.
And not only winning these rounds, Rod, but winning them decisively.
We don't want to force it, okay? That's where you're giving him an advantage. You're trying to force it. He wants you to pop. I'm a man. Hey, keep fucking sticking with that jab. He's dropping those lights. We don't want to play this fight.
For me, is that he's made major improvements.
Get the win. Last time
I
was here at the Red Hat.
Yes, based on your conversation.
Hey, nice stick. You're right.
Don't make a mistake here. This is his fight.
Last round. There's no need to go out there and get recognition. He's done such a good job in his first three rounds.
Another big breath. Come on.
He is new to the game. He may want to close the show. And he's able to close the show against Juarez. As long as he doesn't get recognition, he can win it in the right hand and move him away from the right hand of Juarez.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the fourth and final round.
And you can see his fan club up. I'm sure he'd like to find a way to end this with some fury. Nawid Zaman, our first bout here tonight.
And just like he started off the first round, a good triple jab there. Though it's not dangerous, Rod, but it's keeping Juarez, it's keeping his mind busy so he can't think of a game plan to attack Zaman.
Caught him with a left there. Zaman engages again off the rope.
Oh, and a beautiful right hand.
Boom. Whoa.
Zaman spun off the ropes. Juarez turned to go follow him and walked right into a beautiful short right hand. What a beautiful move by a man with not a whole lot of experience to execute that.
Well, the end could be near here. Nawid Zaman, Donovan Boucher, making sure that Marlon Perez Juarez is okay. A little glassy-eyed here. We'll see. The end could be near. Perez
doing a perfect job.
Oh, look at that. Now he comes back again. Still fighting. Look at them go here. Zaman looking for the finishing blow early in the fourth round. Billy Martin said, keep punching, keep punching. You've got him, you've got him. There's another right. Hard to believe that Perez Juarez has been able to hang on here. Look out.
Lots of time left here in the fourth and final round.
Nawid Zaman, and down he goes. It looked like it was a clinch, though. And
that was a slip and a push.
Final minute to come here. Nawid Zaman trying to put on the finishing touch. He has looked impressive in his second pro fight here at the Owl's Nest. The right, the left. Perez Juarez still hanging in, still hanging tough.
And still coming forward, walking right into those shots from Zaman.
Zaman, though, relentless here, tireless. Another push. Final 30, trying to put the rock to the canvas. Perez Juarez taking a lot of shots here, Stevie.
A lot of shots. And Donovan Boucher having a very, very close look here.
Hanging in. This is Nawid Zaman's fight. The question is, will it end in a knockout? Doesn't look like it. Setting up for one final one, maybe. Final 10. Zaman.
Oh, and a beautiful left hook followed up to the right hand.
Well, he did not knock out the Mexican fighter, but he knocked him down a couple of times. And I would say that the pizza man delivered tonight.
Delivered a double extra large, and what a great opener here at the Owl's Nest to start this night of boxing off.
Nawid Zaman. You know, the odometer is ticking. Older fighter, but boy, fights like a young guy, doesn't he?
Fights like a young guy, and again, I'm close with Billy Martin, his coach. He trains like a young guy. Even though he's doing the pizza thing and doing his thing on the side, he's in the gym, he's learning, he's trying, and you've seen it here tonight. I mean, Juarez is a tough dude, but Zaman stuck to his game plan from the first round to the last, worked behind that beautiful long jab and landed some big, big right hands, which caused a few knockdowns. A vast improvement from his pro debut here tonight.
Only his second pro fight. Gonna win another here. Gonna go to 2-0. I don't think there's any doubt. Marlon?
There was a short right hand that I talked about, Rod.
Oh, yeah.
Zaman spun off the ropes. That was more of the push in the earlier in the round.
Well, what a night already. We've got some action tonight here in the Owl's Nest in Boxfest 5. And what a good opening act.
Great opening act, and hats off to Marlon Juarez. I mean, we've got to give these guys credit. They hop on a plane, they fly down here all the way from Mexico. It's a new environment, new everything. And he could have taken away out easily in that fight. He got hit with a lot of big shots, but he fought hard, he fought to the bitter end. So, I mean, you got to tip your hat off to a tough warrior like Juarez.
See a lot of cowboy hats in here. We're going to have to get a cowboy hat, I think, or two. Tonight's Texas night, Texas takeover. Of course, Owl's Nest down south as well, and Carlos Nava is going to be fighting later tonight in the main event. And here is the
ladies
decision.
And gentlemen, after four rounds of action, we go to the judges' scorecards. All three judges at ringside see it identically, rendering a unanimous decision of 40-34 to your winner, Nawid Zaman.
No doubt about it, Nawid Zaman. Oh, his fans are loving it. His friends are loving it. I think he's loving it.
And a well-earned victory, Rod. He boxed so well from the opening round all the way up into the fourth round. He didn't fall into war as his game plan in exchanging in a war. And he looked really, really good tonight.
George Nassios inside the ring is going to grab our winner tonight, Nawid Zaman.
Congratulations. Another impressive victory. Looked like you smelled blood in the water there after you knocked him down the first time in the fourth. Were you going for the kill there? What was your strategy after that?
First of all, I want to say alhamdulillah. Thanks God for everything. Thanks to my team. Thanks to the best coach right there, Billy, Thomas, and all the hard knock teams and the people who came to support me. This guy's a warrior. He can take punches, no doubt. You know, it was a good experience for me. Yeah.
I see your fan contingent there. They were pretty loud. I'm wondering, last time, can we see some of the signs again? What is it? Pizza made downtown, served in Brampton. Can we see those signs again, like from your fans? Maybe they threw them out. But last time you told me that your business partner, Luigi, you had a $5,000 bet with him that if you knock somebody out, which you did, that he'd have to give you 5 G's. My question is, did he pay you on that bet? And did you make another bet with him this time around?
Yeah, he did. He did. He's a man. Yeah.
What about this time around? Any more bets? Or?
No more bets, because he knows I'm capable of more than that. He doesn't lose money. What was that, yeah?
I got you. I wouldn't want to lose 5,000 each time either. Now, 34, you say age is just a number. 1-0, 2-0 now. What's next? Do you want to have another fight quicker? But what's your plan from here?
Well, I'm not here to want to fight, be a little pro fighter, have a little pro thing on my Instagram. I'm here for big plans, big goals. And all 168ers, watch out.
And I know everybody's got the Pizza Man signs. You want to shout out your business at all, or you want
to? They're not my fans. They're my family. That's my brotherhood since day one. My high school friends. I got a big brotherhood. There's no fans, yeah.
Great fans, great performance again. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Nawid Zaman.
Yeah, extra spicy tonight, Nawid Zaman. Thank you, George. And Nawid Zaman lights it up here. Opening bout, Saturday night. All right, for fighting here in Brampton tonight. Really like Nawid Zaman. And of course, here at the Owl's Nest, you look around the great facility, you'll see lots of fans looking to get the latest Red Owl gear, including t-shirts, hats, hoodies, and much more. Even if you're not here, the latest Red Owl fashion is available to you as well. Get it now. For fight number two here, Boxfest 5 tonight. If it's anything like the first bout, we're in for a great night. Buckle up, everybody. Once again, here's Dave Needman.
Ladies and gentlemen, the action continues here at the Owl's Nest. About to make his walk down to the squared circle. A warm welcome, please, for Eder Clervoix.
My name is Eder Clervoix. I'm 30 years old, from Montreal, Quebec. My current record is 2-3 with one knockout. I've been good, you know, since the last fight. Switched trainers, and training's been doing great. So I'm just hoping to just put all my new skills into the next fight. To be honest, it's not about motivation or anything. That is just about what I want to accomplish for myself. You know, like, I had a rough start in boxing in my professional career. I just wanted to prove to myself that I could do it. I feel great. To be honest, I feel like I went back to my old self when I was on the national team. And I really got to just get my style out there. And I believe I'm going to have a better performance than last time.
So looking forward to this one. All-Canadian battle. Two Canadian guys who were not born in Canada. Eder Clervoix, former national champion and a guy on the national amateur team. 2-3-0 with one knockout, Stevie. Hails from Montreal, Quebec, was born in Port-au-Prince, Haiti.
Clervoix is a very talented kid. I've seen him fight here before. He's had a great stable in Montreal. As you know, Montreal's the boxing hotbed of Canada. There's just so many great champions and so many gyms and trainers around there. So I'm looking forward to seeing him perform here tonight.
Coming off a fourth round decision in May. Fight that was costly, though. Got his nose broken.
And now about to make his way down to the ring, please welcome P.G. Tondo.
My name is P.G. Tondo. I'm 28 years old. Born and raised in Philippines, 12 years, and then moved here when I was 12, turning 13. Started boxing just because of my dad's influence. My dad used to come home every weekend and there would be fights. He would stay up late watching these fights, and I would sort of watch it with him, and also the anime Ippo. I think part of the reason is because I love the sport, but at the same time, I want to leave a legacy for my offsprings in the future to know that I tried and I'm still going after, God willing, the Canadian title. Yeah. When you win, that feeling of winning, it's unexplainable. Yeah. Oh man, I'm excited. I'm just ready to fight, mm-hmm. you know? I just want to put on a good show for the people.
Mm-hmm. And here he comes. PG Tondo, known as PG. His given name, though, is Praise Giver. He wants to be a Punisher Giver here tonight. These two guys, again, PG from Manila, Philippines, though, has represented Canada at the highest level. In fact, competed at the Pan Am Games. Two guys, 28 and 30 years old. Very similar paths, though, through the Canadian amateur ranks.
Like I mentioned earlier, Rod, I feel that this is a bigger fight than just who's going to win the fight. It's going to be who's the most dominant, who's going to take over here at Red Hell in this weight class, who will be the next to get the spot on the card.
Here comes PG Tondo. 1-5-1. The knockout. Coming by us here and with his entourage. This is one that we've been looking forward to tonight here at Owl's Nest. PG Tondo and Eder Clervoix.
Ladies and gentlemen, Red Owl Boxing presents Six Rounds or Less in the Bantamweight Division. Sponsored by Remy Martin, our three judges scoring the bout at ringside, Jasper Kujawski, Mark Simmons, and Martin Dalida. And once the action begins, the third man in the ring, Floyd Porter. Introducing first on my left, fighting out of the blue corner and tonight wearing black with stars. He weighed in at the bantamweight limit of 118 pounds even. His official record is 2 wins against 3 defeats, 1 win coming by way of knockout. Hailing from Montreal, Quebec, by way of Port-au-Prince, Haiti, ladies and gentlemen, introducing Eder, King Kong Clervoix. And his opponent on my right, fighting out of the red corner and tonight wearing all black. His official weight, 117 and a half pounds. He enters the ring with a record of 1 win against 5 defeats and 1 draw. 1 win coming by way of knockout. Fighting out of Toronto, Ontario, by way of Manila, the Philippines. Ladies and gentlemen, here is PG Tondo.
Gentlemen, you were given your instructions in the changing room. I expect you to obey those instructions. Belt lines are good. Remember to protect yourselves at all times. Listen for my commands. Touch bell, touch gloves now if you wish. Come out with the bell.
So here we go. Canadian battle.
And Rod, haven't seen both these guys fight before, knowing the history. It's going to be the classic boxer versus the puncher. Eder's got to box from the outside, and PG's got to kind of go in there and be a little wild and rough him up and really beat him down. I feel that's how this fight's going to be determined.
Both in black trunks, both similar gloves. The red sleeve for Tondo. Clervoix with the blue side and those stars on his trunks. You mentioned Evan Gallard earlier and recently fought Tondo back in March, the Royal York.
And that was a good fight for PG. I mean, it was a lot closer than I anticipated it was going to be. I'd been, as I was training Evan Gallard, PG fought very well. And even here early, he's looked like he's a lot more composed than he usually is. Boxed a nice pop in that jab.
As we saw in the first fight, just a four-rounder, more of a sense of urgency in a four-round fight. Kind of playing each other out here.
And both these guys have a lot of amateur experience. They've been in the game a long, long time. Though their professional records aren't that much, they've been in the gym a long time. They know how to pace themselves for a six-round war here tonight.
Clervoix again coming off a win. The last Owl's Nest match, but again, suffered a broken nose and was bleeding a lot in that fight. Both game fighters, though. Tondo from the Philippines originally, grew up in the Toronto area.
Under trainer Armin Titorescu, son of the late great trainer Adrian Titorescu, who's my professional coach when I first came into the game. So there's a lot of knowledge and experience behind the Atlas boxing team.
Titorescu tree runs deep, does it not? Those roots through boxing, just not only in Ontario, but across Canada, around the world. Doing a lot of dancing here early on.
And PG's got to, he's got to not follow, he's got to not follow Clervoix around the ring. I mean, he's just kind of following him without throwing punches. You got to double the jab up, throw 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and push Clervoix to the ropes so he can't just keep scooting out and scooting out and scooting out.
Oh, there's an engagement early on here, and that's first round. 20 seconds now. Hondo is missing that time. Clervoix eyes him up again. Final 10 seconds, pretty even, Steven.
It's a very even round, very close round, and a feel-low round. These guys have a lot of experience, but if I had to give the edge to anyone, I'd definitely give it to Clervoix. He boxed nice, and he made PG miss, and he made PG rush and follow him.
PG again, just a 1-5-1 record. Let's get into the corners now.
Attention, he will load his crochet bientôt, all right? Grand respect.
Good job, as you keep those feints going.
Continue to play with your jambes, déranger avec ton jab and les feints. Le reste, tu fais super bien ça, okay?
More water. Very good work in there. Keep the hands up. Very good.
On va commencer à mettre un peu plus de pression. Crash, c'est correct. Crash là, c'est correct. Speed. On va commencer à mettre plus de pression pour plus de tes jambes, okay? Mouthpiece.
Okay, round two. Steve Molitor is an edge to Clervoix in round one. Scheduled for six here. PG Tondo, Eder Clervoix. Starting to really fill up here tonight. Five card Boxfest 5 in Brampton. Great facility here.
And PG starting this second round off a lot better. That's exactly what he's got to do. Let punches go in 4, 5, 6 punch combinations and back Clervoix up and shut him down permanently.
Clervoix was thinking about retiring not too long ago and talked back into the ring and entered the ring back in May at Boxfest 4. Got a win. So he's got the mojo back. Like to get another win.
And he's boxing well here tonight. He just got to be careful not stand flat-footed after throwing his combination in front of PG Tondo. Because PG's a very, very strong puncher. And after Clervoix punches, he has to scoot out of there instead of waiting for a receipt.
These are two guys who have, again, as amateurs, and you know it, Steve, to be a boxer around the world, but especially in Canada too, and you know, you gotta have a part-time job. It's so tough.
It's so tough, and you mean the lack of activity, the lack of excitement. You mean it's just almost everything to keep you out of the game or keep you unmotivated. But the real fighters, the cream always rises to the top, and you mean you weather the storm and you fight through it, as I did, and as some of these other guys are going to, Andrew Zoltarani, who we're gonna have on the show with us later tonight. I mean, the real warriors always come out. And some good work by PG Tondo, letting his hands go, some good body shots.
Flurry here, those quick hands, just snapping them now.
And he's starting to open up. And like I mentioned earlier, Rod, that's what he has to do. Four, five, and six. And Black crawl up on the ropes where he doesn't have a chance to get away.
Uppercut when he's there, PJ.
What an uppercut, they say, from the ring here.
Come up with the uppercut when you think there. Come up.
Carrad does not like those body shots, and PG Tondo knows it.
Tondo, who represented Canada at the 2015 Pan Am Games in Toronto, lost in a qualifier. Proud moment for him. Clervoix was a three-time Gold Gloves champion and a national amateur champion.
There's been a real shift here, Rod. I've noticed in the past 45 seconds, PG's starting to land some hard, strong shots, and Carrad does not have an answer.
Oh, look at Tondo go here. Just throwing him now. Clervoix trying to duck out of that.
And it all started with the body shots, Rod. He just went beast mode on the body, and Clervoix has no answer. Now he's been zinged up top to the head. And that was a good, good round for PG Tondo.
PG Tondo's round for sure there. Great flurry. And again, let's go to the corners.
A little bit of ice, Lance, in the back. Great, relax. Hey, beautiful. Don't chase that body, okay? One, two, when you get in there, hit that body, then come up to the head, okay? Because he doesn't like the body shot, okay? Like that body stuff. When he turns off on you, hit him with
Texas
that hook.
Night here tonight.
That hook is your best punch.
Cowboy hats, cowboy boots in because of the main eventer, Carlos Nava, and of course the Red Owls South, Owls Nest South, that is opened in Houston. What a great connection between this boxing center and the one in Houston just opened. So the theme tonight is Texas. And the theme in this fight, this bantamweight fight so far, round one, Clervoix, round two to Tondo.
This is gonna be a big round for both men. And Tondo coming out, a good counter shot by Clervoix, but Tondo was coming out with the energy, letting his hands go early.
Tondo stalking him now. Clervoix trying to snap a couple jabs in. Can't find an opening, though.
And I just don't feel he has the power and strength to keep PG off him. I don't think PG respects his power. So it's just the movement that Clervoix has to keep himself safe. And PG's just got to be careful, as I mentioned earlier, not to follow him around the ring, to cut off the ring with shots.
Lefty against the righty here, and there's that left. Comes again, oh, he got hit that time. Tondo got hit with a quick short right from Clervoix. Nothing really punishing from either fighter so far.
Nothing really big, but I have a feeling when PG lands, his shots just feel like they take more of a toll on Clervoix than when Clervoix lands clean on Tondo.
Clervoix with those stars on those black trunks from Montreal, Quebec. What a hotbed for boxing for such a long time, province.
See former Canadian champion Howard Grant of the Grant Brothers Boxing down there. As I mentioned earlier, that's just the hotbed. The Las Vegas of Canada is in Montreal. I train there myself, and I just know that every gym you walk into, there's a world champion or a world title contender, and the energy is just so much different than most of the gyms here in Ontario.
Remember the legacy, of course, of the Hilton Brothers for such a long time, and
Stefan Ouellet.
go down the list. So many great fighters. Clervoix trying to add his name. He says his goal to be a world champion. 30 years old. Got to get through these fights too.
And this is a better round for Clervoix. He's boxed a lot better. He's thrown a lot of good counter shots. And he hasn't got stuck on the ropes when PG's got him on the ropes. He's always spun off and got away out of harm's way.
Yeah, seemed to stem the tide here. Late rally here. Final 10 seconds for Clervoix, and probably pretty even Steven round here for both fighters.
Keep squeezing, PG. Work. Come on.
Oh, nice duck that time.
Uppercut. Sit on that uppercut, PG.
Final few seconds now. in round three, scheduled six here in Brampton tonight. There's the bell.
That's a good round by both men. That was a close round, Rod. I got to be honest. That was a close one to call. But very entertaining. Both men kind of did a little bit of what each man wants to do. Wall with Fox, beautiful on the outside, countering them.
Good. He's going to have him on the rope here. Okay. That's all it is.
Good shot.
All right.
Quick fighters. Let's quickly get to the fighters.
Comme t'as fait au début du round, s'il rentre passer ton jab, tu lèves tes mains, tu reviens avec la droite dans le milieu. Et là, toute la soirée, OK? Tombe pas endormi parce qu'il est dangereux encore. Ah, respect. Il va commencer à loader, là. Il va mettre plus de pression, tu utilises plus tes jambes. OK? Je veux pas que tu les changes. Je veux pas que tu cherches trop la droite. Attends qu'ils se compromettent pour la droite. All right?
Close fight here. PG Tondo. Eder Clervoix. Chess match. Turbo chess continues now. Two very quick fighters. Could be a turning point round right here, right now, round four.
Nice and tight, PG. Yeah. Keep squeezing, PG.
Herbois just seems so determined as those eyes, the gate just fixated on Tondo. Hasn't changed his expression very much through this fight.
And he's aware, and I think that he feels the power of Tondo, so he knows that he is. His defense has to be on point tonight. There is no room for error with the power of Tondo.
His father was a missionary, very religious background, hence the name Praise Giver, PG Tondo. Oh, there's a low shot there, close to being too low, but nice body shot by Tondo.
And he's got to remember, and here he goes back to the body again. That's what got him in the second round there. That's where it really turned things around for him. He's landing those good body shots. We can't forget what was successful.
Live around the world tonight, Rod Black, Steve Molitor, George Natsios, and our crew here in DAZN, wherever you're watching. Second bout of five tonight. Tondo steps forward again. One thing about both of these guys, you know, Clervoix, sometimes early in your pro career, you haven't faced too many lefties, but I'm sure Clervoix faced a lot of them in his amateur career.
A lot of his amateur career, and again, being in that environment up in Montreal, to get sparring for southpaws, I'm sure is a lot easier than here in Ontario. And he's doing a good job. He's staying away from PG's left hand. He's moving to his left constantly because he knows PG's a strong fighter, and when you move to the right, you're gonna walk right into the left hand.
Past the midway point, round four, scheduled six. Oh, there's a big left that time. Didn't hurt Clervoix, but another body shot. Tondo's starting to assert here.
More than one shot, PG.
Corner telling him more than one shot.
And they're right, because he's still, like I mentioned earlier, he's just walking towards him without throwing punches in accumulation. If you throw one, Clervoix's gonna slip it and move. He's got to keep him in the corner. We're throwing five and six. But when he throws one, it gives Clervoix the chance to slip, roll, and get off the ropes and scoot out. And then PG's got to start that whole process over again of walking him down.
Clervoix trying to lead with that jab again. Snapped it a couple of times. No one's really been hurt so far in this fight. Another cat and mouser here, but it's hard to say who's the cat and who's the mouse.
Yeah, these last two rounds are a lot. Very tough to score. I'm glad I'm not a judge during this fight.
Wow.
The first two rounds are pretty decisive. The last two have been give or take for either man. So the judges are going to have a tough night on their hand calling this one.
Back to the corners again.
You want to fight boxing
round five
before?
Coming up.
You got to win the next two rounds. Clear. You can win this fight.
I got it. Round five. That's it. He's sneaking off one side or the other. Don't circle with him. Cut him this way and then catch him with a double hook going out this way or the other way, okay? You gotta put pressure on this guy now. You can't just be waiting. You gotta move the head. Gets to look small now. Move that head. Jab, jab. One, two, come in, dig the body. You gotta come back to the head. Okay, you gotta come back to the head. All
right? What would you say right now, Steve, for both corners? For Clervoix right now, what does he have to do?
You just got to start letting more punches go. As Tondo's come in, he's got to let those hands go, spin out, and catch him again. He's just throwing one-shot counters and just moving away from Tondo. And if I'm Tondo's coach, you got to start letting punches go four or five or six and keep him on the ropes or in the corner. Don't let him scoot out and make you have to start all over again. And a beautiful short right hand from Clervoix there as he moved to his left and Tondo moved into the right hand.
Round five, close fight. No one has really dominated the last couple of rounds. See if the game changes here now. Gee, Tondo really dancing, looking sharp.
He does, he really seems up on his toes, kind of like a young Manny Pacquiao.
Young Steve Molitor. More IBF super bantamweight champion. Gosh, it got deja vu here on a Saturday night with you. Usually I'm calling wins for you up at Casino-rama. So good to be with Steve Molitor. And I'm sure at the time, a lot of these guys in the ring were looking up to you.
Well,
these weights.
Hopefully, and hopefully they watched the good things I did, not the bad.
Don't let him push you back, PG.
G. Tondo. Yeah, right there. Yeah. Oh, there's a hard right, yeah, right to the side of the head. Might have stung Clervoix.
Yeah.
There's another roundhouse.
And it's a good round for PG. He's really starting to let his hands go. And he's mixing it up to the head and the body. And that's making the difference here in this round, mixing up to the head and the body. And it's made the difference the whole fight. When PG really goes to the body, Clervoix wants nothing to do with him.
Clervoix starting to get on his toes too, starting to do some dancing now, midway through round number five of six. Will it go six? There's a shot by both fighters.
Keep squeezing, PG.
There's a good overhand left from PG and another left hand.
This is wildly that time. Good duck here from Clervoix. And moving those hands now, Steve.
He's moving those hands and moving those feet, but he's got to start throwing those hands because, yes, your defense is good, but from a judge's standpoint of view, you're losing this fight. I mean, you're getting hit, may it be on the shoulders, arms, side of the gloves, but you're not landing anything significant.
He's going to have to score here big late in round five. He has been doing a lot of standing, just watching, maybe waiting for a moment, but Tondo's giving him nothing here. There's another hard left. Tondo now baiting him.
Come on, PJ, yeah.
Corner says he's hurt.
Let's go, PJ, combination.
I'm not sure if he's hurt, but he definitely respects the power of PG Tondo, and that's why he's been on this bike this fifth round.
Tondo now, the hands down. And you'd have to say that's PG Tondo's round for sure.
Absolutely, and it all started with great body work. I mean, when he started hitting Clervoix to the body, Clervoix wanted nothing to do with it, and that was a difference maker, and then PG could really start letting those big shots go.
Be smart. Okay, you got one more round. Don't be stupid. This guy's running from you. He does not want what you got. You got to keep squeezing him. Stay low to him so he doesn't push you back. Okay? You can stop this fucking guy. You can stop this guy. Don't lose this round and don't get stupid. Okay? Keep focused. One, two. Push him to whatever side he goes, to the ropes, whatever. Keep him there. Even if you got to push him a little bit, body, body, head, head, and keep cutting that ring off. He can only run fucking forever, right? He can't run forever.
Don't. As I said earlier, for me, that's the punches.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the sixth and final round.
The output of Clervoix.
So PG Tondo's only had one win in seven fights. If he can hang on here, you'd have to think, we're not judges, we're not scoring this, but based on just the eye test, Tondo's definitely leading this fight.
He's definitely ahead of, he's definitely got the lead, but it is a very close fight. We're not sure what these judges are counting. They could count, oh, we like his clean boxing, but for me, PG's definitely ahead on this fight, on the scorecards here tonight.
Clervoix needs to score here in this final round, maybe even try to hurt Tondo, who has not received many blows here. Tondo coming forward and made Clervoix circle all night long.
PG's got to let his hands go, you know what I mean? here in the first minute of the sixth and final round. I mean, he's just walking and falling around the ring. He's got to let his hands go and stop him in his tracks. And there's a good check hook from PG there.
Tondo goes low, then high again. PG Tondo looks like he's just stalking him right now. Trying to go in for the kill, it looks like. But Clervoix, he's got lots left in the tank, it looks like. Question is, what is on the judges' scorecards right now? Time left here in this sixth and final round. Bantamweight fight here tonight.
And PG just continues to stalk him. And Clervoix's got to remember, whether those punches landing are clear or not, or clean, they're still landing punches that the judges are seeing.
Different story than his last fight when he won a decision. There was a big blow that time. Got Clervoix, got him again.
And some hard, hard shots landed from PG Tondo.
Tondo. Again, feeling it here. Clervoix just backing up almost the entire final round. Self-defense here. Tondo, oh, swung wildly and just missed wildly.
And this is the round that PG Tondo needed, not only to win the fight, but to definitely, in my eyes, Rod, to secure the fight. This is a great round here from him. He just got to keep doing what he's doing.
Just got hit short left that time. That's one of the few that got through. It's been a great wall he's built up in front. Final 30.
And though Clervoix had good footwork and he's boxed very, very, very well, it's been far and few between of the nice combinations and the slipping out and coming back with counter shots in between. It's been the pressure and the strength and the overall will and determination of PG Tondo. For me, Rod, that's going to give him the victory here tonight.
Tondo again was kind of looking for the knockout. Not sure he's going to need it, though. Just not many punches landed by Clervoix. PG Tondo in an all-Canadian amateur bout here are two guys who have turned pro, and PG Tondo may be getting off the schneid here and finally getting his second win.
Like I said before the fight started, it's going to be a boxer versus a puncher, and tonight the boxer won. He applied a lot of pressure. He eliminated the counter shots of Clervoix. And there was nothing, he had no answers for the pressure, and the body shots were a big thing tonight for PG Tondo that I feel made a big, big difference throughout this whole fight tonight.
PG Tondo, let's take a look at some of the action here. Here's a guy also, he used to be the sparring partner for Mandy Bujol. At one time when she was training, because he was a southpaw, just naturally helped her out. So he helped her become a champion.
And whether she's a female or not, Mandy Bujold is a great, great fighter. Oh, a Canadian legend in the amateur game from Kitchener, Ontario, where I reside now. A great ambassador for the sport. So to be up against her is no knock against him. That's great work. World-class level.
Yeah, world-class tonight for the most part. PG Tondo's, you'd have to say, you know, I guess if we talk the vernacular of the kids, the lingo of the kids, he was lit tonight, and he was trending. He was definitely trending. Let's see if the judges concur. You sometimes never know, but you'd have to think it's Tondo's fight here. Bout number 2 of 5. Three still.
Ladies and gentlemen, after 6 rounds of action, we go to the scorecards. All 3 judges see the bout unanimously, 58-56, to your winner by unanimous decision, PG Tondo.
PG Tondo has his second win in 8 fights as a pro, and it wasn't a punishing fight by any stretch, but it was dominant by Tondo.
And he earned it, Rod. You mean PG fought really, really hard. He wanted to win in there tonight. He showed not only the crowd, himself, and the judges, but he showed myself as well that he wanted to win this fight. He tried different things. He mixed it up to the head and the body. He applied a lot of pressure. He cut the ring off. He did everything he could to win the fight tonight. He deserved to win, and he had a great performance.
Let's go to George Nassios now with PG.
Here with your winner, PG Tondo. PG, great performance. Your eighth career fight, you only had one win before this, but you'd never been knocked out, always been on the wrong side of so many decisions. How good did this feel to be on the right side of the judge's decision?
You know, what can I say? All glory to God. Give me this victory. I feel fantastic, you know? It's been such a long time, and this feels like a fucking career high for me. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for everyone who supported me. Thank you for my family. Thank you for my friends. Thank you for my gym. Thank you for Armando, Ernesto. Thank you for Lance. I appreciate all of you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, PG! Now, you definitely seemed like the aggressor as the fight wore on. He was kind of dancing to the outside and you were falling around. Was there any frustration with there, or what was the plan there? Were you trying to get him to the middle of the ring?
Oh, no, of course. I've always been the chaser, so I knew that I was going to chase either way. Yeah, so once, I know once I clip him once, they'll all start running. So, yeah, it's always been the plan.
The first round was really cagey, but is that second round where you really seem to get some really good body shots and go on the attack more? Did you feel a little more inspired after you hit a couple there?
Yeah, we've actually focused on this training camp to go through the body, because I know we have six rounds, so we're going to take our time. Yeah.
Now, I know as a kid growing up, you got into boxing because your father was really into it. You used to watch the fights really late with him. Who do you think of? Who do you want to thank at a time like this when you get your second career victory?
My second career victory, I have nothing but to thank my camp. They've really pushed me through. I was ready to quit, man. I was ready, but these guys kept me on pace. So, yeah, thank you for all my coaches, thank you for my friends, and for everyone who supported me along the way.
And your first win in almost 4 years. You got to be inspired now. What's next? When do you want to get in the ring next?
We're going for a Canadian title.
Canadian title?
Yes.
Well, we hope to see it. Congratulations again.
Yeah, thank you, thank you. Thank you.
PG Tondo.
Yeah, that's a guy. He reminds me of you, you know. He's an assassin, a great boxer. Nice guy, though.
Very nice guy. Very, very well spoken.
Golden smile.
Yeah, golden smile, golden heart. And he does have a good team behind him, Armentita Rescue and the rest of the team over at Atlas Boxing. So I hope nothing but the best for him, because he's a very polite, well-mannered, respectable kid.
Chaser wins tonight and eyeing a possible Canadian championship. There's the cowboy hats and
yeehaw.
Girls, yeehaw! This isn't our first rodeo, is it?
Absolutely
no,
not.
It's not. It's Texas Takeover tonight, because of course Red Owl Performance Center, Owl's Nest, has teamed up with Houston, Texas for another Boxfest, and of course they've already had one at the Owl's Nest South. And Red Owl President Gabriel Fanous has a clear plan in place to give fighters what they want deep down in the heart of Texas. And Owl's Nest South is something big and getting bigger.
I think one of the main things that we talked about too is, does this solve a problem?
Yeah.
Boxing, I don't think no one has went over and beyond and gave fighters a consistent schedule to fight on for as long as we're talking about doing it. That fighters, trainers, and managers all alike are going to fall in love with that piece right there. So as we flesh this thing out and we turn it from concept to reality, I think a lot of heads are going to turn, and people are just going to be naturally drawn to it, because it's consistent.
Because if we use Houston as a case study and prove that it can work there with new incentive structure, new organizational structure, consistency in fights, everybody cooperating together, we wanna structure it the same way that every other sport operates. That's it, you know? There's no magic sauce. It's just like, let's build this better.
Been a great night so far. We've had wins by the Canadians, Nawid Zaman and PG Tondo, of course from the Philippines, but represents Canada. And now we're ready for bout number three at Boxfest 5 tonight. Here's Dave Needman.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are set to commence the next bout of the evening. Now making his way down to the ring, please welcome Eduardo Molina.
Me llamo Eduardo El Peligro Cortés. Yo soy de la Ciudad de México, del barrio de Santa Julia. Porque en mi debut, noqueé en el primer round a los 42 segundos. Mucha satisfacción, ya que los entrenamientos son muy, muy fuertes. Mi barrio es muy peligroso, entonces todos debemos aprender a defendernos y eso me llevó a iniciarme en el boxeo. Yo mañana sinceramente veo un knockout, pienso noquear en el segundo round con un gancho al hígado, porque hay que darle show a la gente y no quiero noquear en el primero, hay que darle un buen show.
So again, Mexican fighters making their way north of the border. Eduardo Cortes Molina, 1-1-0 with a knockout from Mexico City, Mexico, the 28-year-old. And his last fight a year ago, he got knocked out in the second round. And he says he is looking for a second round victory here tonight. Will not be easy. Another Canadian coming his way. Love the fireworks, love the entrances here. Don't you wish you had an owl's nest when you were a young pro?
Absolutely. What a great facility. I mean, the seating here, the gym here, the ring set up 24/7. What an opportunity for these young fighters here in Ontario and Canada to grow their boxing career, especially with places like the owl's nest.
And now, set to make his walk down to the squared circle, please welcome Mathusan Mahindas.
Hi, my name is Mathusan Mahindas. I'm a professional boxer out of Scarborough, Ontario. It was a good fight. I fought a good opponent that night. He was undefeated as well. He put up a better fight than I thought he would. At the end of the fight, I thought I won more of the four rounds, but the judge didn't see it that way, but it is what it is. I'm not stuck on it, I'm past it, life goes on. Yeah, so being the first Tamil Canadian professional boxer, I feel like I'm the pioneer to my people in this. Since I've started, there's been other Tamil boxers, like amateur boxers coming up, and I kind of like, you know, I was the first to do this, so I guess they might have seen me like cutting my way, going to provincials, doing the grind of like an amateur boxer. And now they're seeing me turn the flag over to becoming a professional and making my way in the professional ranks. So it's really good to like see the growth in our community, and it's nice to have people join it. My entire plan for boxing is to end up being the first Tamil Canadian world champion. There's no other way around it.
Here he comes, Mathusan Mahindas, Scarborough's very own 27-year-old, 4-0-1 with a knockout. He has been a busy guy, Steve Molitor, here at the Owl's Nest.
I've seen him fight here several times. He's improving every time out. He's a great boxer, and I think he's going to have his toughest test here tonight against a very tough Mexican in Eduardo Molina.
Makes his way here to the Owl's Nest. Bout number 3 of 5 tonight in Boxfest 5 here in a September Saturday night. Mathusan making his way. And as he is, you know that the Wayne's World movie where you said, I'm not worthy? Well, first of all, I'm not worthy sitting next to you.
Oh.
Steve Molitor, and I'm not worthy. Zoltarani is here as well. And he's going to be calling the fights with us as well. The great Zoltarani is with us, the WBO Global Welterweight Champion. I'm sure he's got lots tonight. Zolt, welcome. Good to have you. Mathusan.
Ladies and gentlemen, Red Owl Boxing presents 4 rounds or less in the junior welterweight division, sponsored by the Aero Group of Companies. Our three judges score in the bout at ringside: Jasper Kujawski, Jeremy Hayes, and Mark Simmons. And once the action begins, our referee in charge, Donovan Boucher. Introducing first, on my left, fighting out of the blue corner and tonight wearing gold trimmed with white. His official weight, 139.5 pounds. He enters the ring with an official record of 1 win against 1 defeat, 1 win coming by way of knockout. He comes to us from Mexico City, Mexico. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing Eduardo Peligro Molina. And his opponent on my right, fighting out of the red corner and tonight wearing black trimmed with red. His official weight, also 139.5 pounds. He is undefeated thus far in the ring with a record of 4 wins against no defeats, 1 draw, and 1 win coming by way of knockout. Hailing from and representing Scarborough, Ontario, ladies and gentlemen, here is Mathusan Tiger Mahindas. Once again, referee Donovan Boucher.
Okay, gentlemen, I'm expecting a good, clean fight. Listen to my command at all times. Protect yourself at all times. Touch gloves. Good luck to both of you.
Boy, a lot of royalty ringside. And in the ring, Donovan Boucher, Mark Simmons, former Olympic fighter. Zoltarani with us, Steve Ballater here. Guys, Mathusan Mahindas from the ends in Scarborough. We're in the black trunks with the red against the Mexican fighter, Eduardo Cortes Molina. What do you think, Stevie?
Mathusan has really got to be smarter. He's really got to box from the outside. You can tell already Eduardo Molina is the type of guy who's just going to come here and try to bang and be strong. He's not going to make it look pretty. So Mathusan Mahindas has got to box and be smart and stay away from that right hand. He can't be moving to his left and walking into the strength and power of Molina.
So how well do you know Mathusan?
So yeah, I know him pretty well, and I know that he's been working on his power lately. So I'm curious to see if that's going to play a part here, because he's been working with different strength and conditioning coaches because, you know, he wants to have more knockouts. So he's been really working on his power, and I think that that's going to be a game changer for his career. And as of right now, I like what he's doing. He's sticking his ground. He just landed a nice right hand.
Cortes Molina, just 1-1. Young pro career, but again, one of the many Mexican fighters sometimes you haven't heard of who would like to make a name for themselves.
When I was down there sparring with Eric Morales, Rod, let me tell you, there's just so many fighters who just want an opportunity. And when they get in there, they bang and they bang hard. So this is nothing new for Molina. He's been in worse situations than this, I mean, in regards to competition or atmosphere. So this is just another day at the office for him. But it's going to be a lot of responsibility on Mahindas to box discipline and stay on the outside and not exchange in a war, get hit with something sloppy like that overhand right thrown by Molina.
And you know, Molina is dangerous because they don't know much about him. I know this. And he's just, like, looking at him now, he has some pop for this weight class. So I think that he's dangerous. And right now, Mathusan needs to be smart. He needs to keep to the game plan, keep popping his jab, and be smart in there and just test him out.
And that's what I noticed from the outset, just the size of Molina. He just looked like a strong, strong man, where Mahindas looks a little bit frailer and thinner. So like we said, Mahindas has got to stick to his game plan, keep that chin down when he's walking in, throwing shots, and watch out for them wild, hard, strong shots from Molina.
Final minute, round one. Mathusan Mahindas coming off a draw in his last bout. A lot of people thought that he should be 5-0.
I called that fight. I definitely thought he boxed well enough to win 3 of the 4 rounds. He didn't get the nod that night, but that's part of boxing. You got to just take your licks as they come and just keep moving on and be positive about it.
Final few seconds, guys. These guys didn't come out conservatively, hey, tonight?
They didn't come out conservatively, and it's been a very good round for Mathusan Mahindas. He's boxed well. He stayed away from that wild overhand right from Molina, and that was a good opening round for Mathusan Mahindas, and a win for me in my book.
Zold, we got a fight.
I like it. I see his power, and he's gone stronger, and it's impressive.
And that's going to be key for him tonight, that he's worked on his strength, because I think the Mahindas before this fight wouldn't have been able to keep a strong guy like Molina off him. Since he's been working on his strength, I think it's been a big key factor here, even in the first round, to keep Molina off him.
Yes, I agree.
Zolt, since we have you, what's going on right now? Tell us about you. I mean, you're the champ. When you fighting next?
Listen.
Tell the world.
Listen,
tell the world.
I'm too good looking. That's the problem. I'm too good looking. I'm the best looking boxer there is. I don't think there's a better looking guy than me.
I don't know.
He's retired. He don't count. You know, I'm ready for anybody. The truth is, everyone's like, they're picky right now, and they're saying that I'm a risk. I'm too much of a risk. And it's annoying because I'm ready to fight these guys in the top 10, but you know, they don't want to fight. That's the truth. And I'm just too strong. I'm too skillful, and I just think that you know, it's a slow time, but I'm ready for anybody, and I'm hoping I can fight these guys. Like Jamal James, he's there. Mario Barrios is there. Keith Thurman. Like, I want these guys, the top guys, to prove to everybody what I'm capable of.
Well, you are good looking, and the best thing is you're starting your TV career as well. But let's hope your TV career can wait. We want to get you back in the ring, right?
Yes, yes.
Zoltarani's with us, the WBO Global Welterweight Champion. With Steve Molitor, the former IBF Super Bantamweight Champion. Rod Black with you ringside. Mathusan, Mahindas, and Eduardo Cortes Molina. This has been a scrap so far.
It has, man. And Mahindas has done a great job of just keeping to his game plan, keeping those hands up, especially that right hand up nice and high, because the only chance that Molina has really had here tonight is those wild winging right hands. But when Mahindas boxes smart like that and throws those nice clean shots down the pipe, Molina's not going to be able to get in or land anything of significance. Double that up!
Not as frantic as we saw in the first round. There's a big left hand that time for Molina. You said it though, Zolt, when you don't know a fighter, it's always tough.
And Zolt can attest to this. When you see a straight-up boxer, a guy like Oscar De La Hoya or Zoltán Randy, you kind of know what's coming. When you're in with a wild, wild guy like this, like Molina, it's tough to gauge or tough to guess, because how are you supposed to know what he's going to throw when he doesn't even know what he's going to throw?
Exactly.
And his couple shots here stems the tide. Maybe that's the opening, though. Let him be wild. Let the wild horse fly and then wait for your opening.
And that's what Mahindas has been doing. He's been making him miss a lot, and eventually it's going to catch up to him.
Molina just looks like he just wants to wind up and throw. That could be costly, though.
Hold to your right.
Molina might tire out, missing all these punches.
Body shot from Mahindas. From Scarborough, Ontario, the burb, where if you're watching around the world, it's just east of downtown Toronto, known as the Ends. Proud of his Tamil culture. Mathusan, nicknamed the Tiger.
And he's in tough. Let's not take anything away from Molina. Molina's a tough, tough, strong, wild guy. So I'm giving a lot of credit here to Mahindas. He's boxed well. He's stuck to his game plan. Hasn't engaged in a toe-to-toe war like Molina wants.
Yeah, Mahindas has faced a few fighters, five so far, four in Owl's Nest. This might be one of his toughest ones.
It's definitely his toughest opponent physically. Skill-wise, I'm not sure, but he just keeps improving every time.
You know what I'm saying? And then don't stand in front of him so much. You're getting caught in like, it's either you're going forward, like inching forward, not diving in forward, inching forward. So when he dives in, you fucking respond tight and counter. When you're countering, you need to be countering more than one. Right now, you're just countering with one. Double your counter, triple up your counters. You got to plan for them ahead of time. Right now, you're just
great. I've been with them almost a year now.
And, those big swings, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. So don't stay in front eyes. Of them.
Great coaches.
That's when guys great. Have a time and, to you know, zone you and fucking
they're doing
line
a great
you
job
up.
With me. And
you know what I'm saying?
We're working on a lot of different things. And honestly, I learned a lot, just even myself, from the fight, my last fight. I know exactly what I did wrong. The truth is, I wasn't impressed at all. You know, always happy to get the victory, but I wasn't happy at all with my performance. And I know exactly what I need to do to become world champion.
And a quick question I have for you, Zol, because I was sort of in the same situation when I moved down to Montreal and trained, and we were talking about earlier, just the atmosphere in Montreal, the different gyms you get to go train, and different looks and world champion, John Pascal, and there's just a lot of world champion. It's just a rich history. How's that worked out for you down there?
It's great. You know why? It's like, it's a different atmosphere. It feels like America. You know when you go to America,
a mini
it's
Las
like,
Vegas.
Yes, that's what it feels like, a mini Las Vegas, and I think it's great to be around those people, and even former world champion.
Because nobody sleeps in
like,
Montreal.
No. And a lot of more people love boxing. Like I realize when, like I'm just walking around, like people, like they know who I am more there than here, you know.
Yeah.
And even other fighters, they know who Lennox is. They just is more of a boxing world. Just like you said, it's a mini Las Vegas. So
it is a mecca for sure, and has been through the years. Mathusan, Mahindas, round three of four here. Eduardo Cortes Molina. Put your judges' caps on, guys.
It's been a great, for me, it's 2-0. Mahindas, no questions asked. He's boxed well from the outside, and now he's starting to land some good, clean shots, and he's starting to dig to the body, so he's really having his way here tonight, and he's impressed me so much. I've seen all his fights here at the Owl's Nest, and this is his, by far his most impressive performance.
He just needs to watch out for, you know, a shot that's going to come out of nowhere. Because even though Molina's getting tired, I can tell, he's still dangerous. He still has, just like right there. You know? That was beautiful combo.
Big right. Right, a left. Molina looks hurt. Molina's really hurt. Molina could be going down here. He might be going down. Body shot now.
There's lots of time left here in the third round.
Oh, look out. Donovan Boucher looking because Molina looks like he's going to fall here. A minute to go. Hanging in, though. Mexican fighters sometimes play possum. Let's see.
Whether he's playing possum or not, he's not going to lay down, and he's going to swing into the bitter end. And that's what Mahindas has to be careful about, those wild looping shots.
Yeah, might catch him here, and I think that's Molina's game plan. He knows his only game plan is to catch Mahindas.
That's the only chance he's really got.
He might survive this round. There's another left to the face.
I like what Mathusan is doing. He has him hurt. He realized he needs to still be smart in there. Now he's settled down a little bit. He realized he needs to catch him again, just like right there.
Oh. Mathusan Mahindas is putting on a clinic.
Great work on the inside from Mahindas.
Eduardo Cortes Molina is still standing. That's a miracle.
He's tough. He's definitely tough. He took some big shots in that round, and he was still coming at the end.
And not even big shots. It was just a lot of great counter shots from Mahindas. Right. And those are the worst type of shots to get hit from. When you throw a shot and you get hit with a counter shot, it's twice the worst as just getting hit with a straight on
shot. Double down.
A great round from Mahindas.
Double down,
inside. Beautiful counter shots from the outside.
Let's listen in now.
Don't hit him hard with the first one. Hit him hard with the third one. You understand? Pop, 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 boom! Hit him hard with the third one.
And you're doing better after
the sound. A lot of M&M in that round.
Great work and great shots in the inside from Mahindas, and just great work overall from him. Using that range, throwing shots down the middle, catching shots in the inside.
See, Eduardo Cortes Molina got rocked a few times, and he was jumping up and down like he was fresh as the fight started. Do you think he's going to be able to last?
This is six rounds. I don't think he'll be able to go six rounds.
And this one's a four-rounder, brother.
Four. Okay.
So Molina has to go for broke, and Mahindas just has to keep doing what he's doing, chipping away at the stone, beating him down with a jab, touching up the body, and cruise to a decision win, or maybe even stop him late if he catches him like he did in the last round.
Cannot make a mistake,
he's still dangerous.
And that's the thing. We've seen, look at that shot. Again, Mexican fighters, we've seen it many, many times. Do not get overzealous. Do not get overconfident.
And do not get comfortable in there.
Cortes Molina hanging in here. Mathusan Mahindas, his corner, saying don't stand in front of it. Mahindas would like to finish him off, though. He had him in round three. Staggered him.
And he staggered him and had him hurt in round three with good, clean boxing. He was boxing on the outside, and he used his jab. He can't stand there in exchange, especially with Molina swinging wild. He has nothing to lose, so it's his best to keep chipping away from the outside.
Who's in Mahindas, undefeated as a pro. Wild swinger, another hard shot, rocked him. Getting up to the last minute, Molina lost his mouthpiece. An uppercut, look out, it's gonna be over, you gotta think. He's still hanging in, still swinging. How is he taking this punishment? Another shot, another one.
Great work from Mahindas on the outside. Great uppercuts and hooks. Just put a beating on Molina. But hats off to Molina for just still coming forward. He's not here to give up.
Those uppercuts are not missing right now.
They're not, and without the mouthpiece in Molina, I'm sure there's gonna be a lot of damage to the inside of his mouth.
He just landed a nice body shot, though. Yeah.
There's some blood there now. Final few seconds. This has been all Mathusan Mahindas from the beginning. He's mauled Molina. Final 30. Molina still throwing punches wildly.
He's just hoping to hurt Mathusan with something so he can slow him down.
Well, he's got to put him out at this point. Slowing him down is not going to do much. This was a great round and a great fight for Mathusan Mahindas, who boxed well from the opening all the way to the finish. Boxed well, hit to the body well, stayed off the ropes. A very good performance from Mathusan Mahindas, and such an upgraded performance from his last outing. Hats off to him and the team, because this kid, every fight I watch him at the Owl's Nest, he's getting better and better.
How about Eduardo Cortes Molina Zolt? He might be the Mexican version of George Chavallo. Still standing.
Yeah, he's tough. He's definitely tough. And not just that he was taking these shots, it's how he was taking it. He was still coming forward after he was taking some big, big shots in there. And I am impressed. I am impressed by both of them. They both did a great job. One of them is very tough. The other one put on a clinic. It was a good fight to watch.
Where do you think the sky is for Mathusan Mahindas?
It's all up to him on where he wants to take it and how much time and effort he wants to put into it. But with the changes of levels that I've seen from his past five fights here at the Owl's Nest, I mean, the sky's the limit for a guy like that. I know he's got a strong team behind him. He has a stage here to build his career at Red Owl at the Owl's Nest and fight regularly, which is one of the biggest factors for an Ontario fighter is being able to have the stage to fight on and stay active. So he has all the opportunities in the world to grow and become as big as he wants to be. It's all on him and on him at this point.
Last fight was a tough decision, Zolt. I don't think there's any decision, any kind of controversy this time.
No, yeah, I think it was pretty easy to judge this one.
Who's in Mahindas? Team Mahindas relishing, and here's Dave Needman.
Ladies and gentlemen, after four rounds of boxing, we go to the judges' scorecards. Judge at ringside, Jasper Kujawski scores at 39-37. Jeremy Hayes and Mark Simmons both have it 40-36. To your winner, by unanimous decision, Mathusan Tiger Mahindas.
At one time for the ends. Scarborough loving it. The Tiger roars here tonight. Mathusan Mahindas. Boy, what a dominant performance. He did everything except knock this guy out.
And a well-earned victory. He boxed so well. And as I mentioned before, he just keeps improving every fight out. And like Zolt had mentioned earlier, he was working on his strength and power. And I think that was a key factor in him keeping Molina at bay and being able to pick him apart from the outside. So hats off to Mathusan Mahindas and his team.
Let's go to George with the Tiger.
Here with your winner, Mathusan Mahindas. And Mathusan, last time out, you didn't get the decision, you had a draw. This time, you didn't really leave it to a decision. That was a pretty decisive victory. How proud are you of that performance?
I'm proud of my performance. I think that guy was really tough. I showcased my power. I didn't get the knockout tonight, but you guys saw what happened in there. So, yeah, I'm happy with what I did.
Now, I know you've said in the past you wanted to develop that knockout power, and you tagged him a few times in that fight. Did you think there was any time that you had him? Because you hit him with some hard, clean shots a number of times.
In the third, I thought I was close, but I kind of let him change the momentum a little bit. I should have kept going back to keeping my momentum. So I felt like that's the mistake I made, which like stopped me from getting the stoppage. But overall, I know I'm going in the step in the right direction, so I'm happy.
Now, you know, this is your fourth time fighting out of five Boxfests at the Red Owl. How good is this home field advantage for you?
I love it. Thank you so much for coming out tonight, guys. You guys have no idea how much I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you from the bottom of my heart, actually. Thank you.
Now, one more for you. Back in the win column now. What's next?
Next is go back to my real weight class. I felt it tonight, if you guys didn't see. And then I'm going to continue my campaign at 135 and under.
Congratulations. Great win.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much for everybody for coming out tonight. I want to thank Power Staffing for all their help in my career. I want to thank my friends and family for showing out tonight. Honestly, I'm just happy everyone came out tonight, and I getting the win makes it so much more sweeter. So thank you, everybody.
Mathusan Mahindas.
Eminem. Well, three bouts down, guys. Three bouts down. Three Canadian victories so far. No more Canadians in any of the fights, but pretty dominant performances for the Maple Leaf.
Great performance by all three Canadians tonight. They boxed clean, they won clean, and we're off to a great start.
Well, if you're coming down to the Owl's Nest or a Boxfest, make sure you pick up some merch here at Red Owl Performance Center. Durrani and Steve Molitor, Rod Black with you. George Nassios ringside. Dave Needman is our ring announcer for bout number four.
Ladies and gentlemen, the time has come for the penultimate bout of the evening. Now making his way down to the ring, please welcome Jorge Acosta.
Mi nombre es Jorge Sevilla Acosta. Vengo del Estado de México. Empecé para mantener mi peso. Era un niño muy gordito. Llegué a un peso donde ya no se me complicaba ya poder estar un poco de pie, pero pues la gente que me rodea. La gente fue la que me hizo amarlo, la que me inspiró a dar más de mí. Mi sueño de boxeo es llegar a ser reconocido, llegar a ser una figura a nivel y motivar a las personas que vienen tras de mí. Por mí, peleó por mí para salir adelante. Este deporte me hizo salir adelante y salir de donde yo estaba.
Welcome back to Box Fast 5 here at the Owl's Nest, and it's the big boys, Zolt, the big boys.
I love watching big boys because anything can happen. It's like a different world. I always tell this to people, where heavyweights, it's a different boxing. It's not the same as any other weight class. It's not like my weight class. You have to train differently. Your diet, everything is just completely different. And you never know, anything can happen in there. So this is always exciting.
And you know, it doesn't matter. And it's not shaming by any stretch. There are some big guys who don't look like they're in the best of shape, but you do not want to get hit by them.
Yes, and you know, this guy over here, I might have to just nickname him the Mexican Butterbean.
Yes.
You know, he definitely looks like Butterbean, but I'm telling you, I can tell this guy can crack. He definitely has some power, so his opponent needs to, you know, watch out for his power. You know, look at Andy Ruiz. You know, you look at his body as well. This guy, he's a former world champion as well. So Tyson Fury, that's another one where it's not the muscle. Sometimes the muscle slow these big fighters down. So I'm curious to see what's going to happen here.
So we've heard of Mexican jumping beans. You're calling him the Mexican Butterbean.
Yes.
Oh,
yes.
There you go. Jorge.
And now set to make his entrance in the arena, please welcome Zamig Atakishiyev.
Zamig Atakishiyev. Я из Азербайджана. Я родился в Азербайджане. Я боксом начал, а я кикбоксер был. И потом начал случайно с чемпионата республики выступал и чемпион стал и продолжал бокс. То и потом да, чемпион Европы гран-при был и потом любительский чемпион Европы был. Да, где-то больше 20 лет. Честно, не могу говорить, но люблю это спорт. Это моя жизнь. Хочу стать чемпионом, как все.
Fight night. Tonight. Bout four of five. Main event still ahead, featuring Texan Carlos Nava. Here is Azerbaijan fighter who has has been around the world fighting. He's 8-2-1, 6 knockouts. Stevie was just talking with Zolt about the big guys. You've been around some big guys. I recall calling some of your fights up at Rama when you had the heavies on the undercard. And I know you were in the background. I know you were getting ready for your fight, but you loved watching the heavies.
I loved watching them. I mean, they always put on a good show, and hopefully we're going to get that here tonight with these two big monsters in there. And that's the thing with heavyweights. I mean, it could be one and done at any time. So I'm looking forward to this fight here tonight.
Not a lot of room in the ring when these guys get around or in the corners. And again, Azerbaijan and Mexico in the ring. The big boys. Here's Dave Neiman.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the big boys of boxing. Red Owl Boxing proudly presents our co-main event of the evening, scheduled for 8 rounds or less. In the heavyweight division, sponsored by DAZN, our judges at ringside, Jasper Kujawski, Jeremy Hayes, and Martin Dalida. And once the action begins, our third man in charge, Floyd Porter. Introducing first, on my left, fighting out of the blue corner and tonight wearing black trimmed with pink. His official weight, 297 pounds. His official record consists of 5 wins against 5 defeats, 2 draws, 3 wins coming by way of knockout. Fighting out of and representing Naucalpan de Juarez, Mexico, ladies and gentlemen, here is Jorge Bombom Acosta. And his opponent on my right, fighting out of the red corner and tonight wearing all black. He weighed in officially at 224 and a half pounds. He enters the ring with a record consisting of 8 wins against 2 defeats, 1 draw, 6 big wins coming by way of knockout. Hailing from Haji Kabul, Azerbaijan, ladies and gentlemen, introducing the hard-hitting Zamig Atakishiyev.
Gentlemen, you were given your instructions in the changing room. I expect you to obey those instructions. This is for my commands. This belt line's a little high. This one's a little low. Remember to protect yourselves at all times. Touch gloves if you wish. Come out at the bell.
Floyd Porter in the ring with the big boys. Jorge Sevilla Acosta, Big Bomba, Zang Kishinev from Azerbaijan. A guy who is not gone the distance very much. The heavies are in the ring here tonight, and bout 4 in our 5 bout card. Main event still ahead with Steve Molitor, Zolt Durrani, ringside here at the Owl's Nest.
I like the jab of Zamig already. He's throwing a nice jab. He's keeping him outside, so that's a good start.
And that's going to be key against a wild, shorter guy like Acosta, is keeping those punches straight down the middle to avoid the wide looping shots.
And Akishniev coming out throwing. Usually there's not a big discrepancy when you have the heavies, but there is a big weight discrepancy. But the reach goes to Zinig.
I think Atakishiyev just landed a body shot that hurt Acosta a little bit.
It was a left hook to the body, and he definitely did not like that body shot.
Acosta has fought in Canada, knows Canadians. His last 2 fights against Edmonton native James Cernak. Majority decision draw followed by a split decision. So he knows Canada.
Zamig's got to give himself some space, because that's where Acosta wants to be. He has no problem with people leaning on him and fighting on the inside. It's going to be very smart of Zamig to stay on the outside and pick his shots and hit him with 1-1 and then a hard 2 down over the top.
Mm-hmm. Just landed a nice right hand, Acosta. He overhand right.
Acosta had him in the corner. Won't see as much dancing as we saw in our first 3 fights. I don't know if these guys dance at all. You can feel the ring shake when they move around it.
They don't dance, but they throw heavy shots, and those are big, big shots that both those men are throwing in there.
It looks like Acosta's already bleeding from the nose.
Yeah, he is leaking there. And those black trunks with a pink on it. Zanega Tishnikov, Azerbaijan, has fought around the world, most experienced fighter in Boxfest 5 tonight. And Akishniev, a couple of hard shot to the body there. Acosta says nothing.
And that usually means something, Rod. Those were two good body shots, especially the left hook around the elbow to the liver.
And more blood from Acosta is dripping now. That's round one. Some heavy leather flying.
And a very, very good round from Zamig Atakishiyev. I mean, he boxed well on the outside. He threw hard, hard shots over top, around the elbows to the body. That was a very good round. As we listen to the Mexican in Acosta's corner. You know he didn't take too much to shoot. He wasn't hurt in years old. He knows well as I do. You cannot consistently round after round just lay on the ropes and let somebody tee off on you. As we hear see Zamig here have Acosta on the rope, just landing shots when he has them at the end of his punch.
Well, said at the beginning that Zanig Akishniev has not gone the distance very much. Again, these aren't marathon runners by any stretch. Good chance that this might not go the distance. Acosta has before. Actually, he has never gone beyond six rounds before Acosta, so I wouldn't say endurance is the name of this fight. I'm looking to end it quick.
With the bombs they landed in the first round, I'd be surprised if it goes eight rounds.
They were chucking them. Akishniev with a couple of body shots.
And Akishniev just got to keep doing what he's doing, just keep chipping away and just keep chopping away at that tree, and eventually it's going to fall. You mean, Acosta's a tough, tough, thick, big man. It's not only going to be one and done here tonight. He's just got to keep chipping away and chopping away that tree until it falls down.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree. I think it's very important to break Acosta down.
And he's done a great job of it here in the opening two rounds, reaching around those elbows, digging to the liver, hitting him up in the middle in the solar plex.
Nice body shot right there again.
Again, some discrepancies in our tail of the tape, obviously, in weight and probably reach, but the biggest discrepancy, guys, is in age. 37 years old to 24 years old at Akishniev. He's been around and has fought a lot of amateur fights and pro fights.
Look at that movement.
Some good head movement from Acosta there.
Andy Ruiz head movement.
And body.
Yeah.
I shouldn't say that because Andy Ruiz has gone through a transformation, so my apologies.
That's true.
That was the old Andy Ruiz body.
True.
The new Andy Ruiz body's
Mexican Butterbean. Yeah, he punches like Butterbean, but has the head movement like Ruiz.
Funny thing, Acosta got into boxing to get in better shape and has through the years. Tell you one thing, he's a scrapper though. He's 2-1-1 in Canada. As we've seen so far, he has an ability to absorb punches.
Floyd Poitier giving a warning to Zamig about leaning his head too close or too hard on the forehead of Acosta.
And that was a nice body shot that Acosta landed.
Coming down to the final few ticks. Round two. Sure how long this one's gonna last. Acosta, though, keeps swinging. Here we go.
Acosta finished strong that round. I like what he was doing at the end of the round over there. He landed some nice body shots, and he still has power. So you look at his body, you know, it's deceiving because he looks like he's in great shape. You know, he's in here. That was the second round. He still has power in the second round. So,
and about a 70-pound discrepancy in weight, which means a lot more than you think, but the skill of Zamig and the knowledge of him and Billy Martin in his corner, you mean he's not going to allow Acosta to land a big wild shot. His hands are up nice when he's throwing his shots, but a 70-pound weight difference can make or break a fight, that's for sure, if he lands clean.
With Steve Molitor, Zolt Durrani, the WBO Global Welterweight Champion, ranked in the top 100. Zolt?
So I'm ranked number 12 in the WBO, and I'm open to fight someone in the top 12. You know, I want to become number one.
We're going to be your promoters here tonight.
All these guys are scared of me. These guys in the top 10 are scared of me.
Tell the world. You're around the world tonight. By the way, you should mention Zolt Durrani is the first fighter signed by Red Owl as well.
Yes.
So you're proud of this place.
Oh, I'm very proud. You know, they started from nothing. They were boxing fans, and, you know, we got in bed together, and it was great. Like, the first time we even met, it was a great feeling, a mutual feeling. It was just great because all of us had the same goals. And, you know, what they're doing here with these shows and putting on these shows for these fighters, and, you know, they're able to stay busy, I think it's great, and I love what they're doing.
And you just gotta love the vision that Gabe and Steve have and the actual commitment and follow through. I've said, been in this game a long, long time. I've seen a lot of people with visions and ideas, but the way that Gabriel and Steve and the rest of the Red Owl team have followed through, and now with Houston, the big Red Owl in Houston, which, you mean, I can't talk enough about how great it is and what the future plans they have. They're really gonna take off with the boxing, even more so than they've done here in Ontario, having regular fights in the regular and giving guys an opportunity and a stage to fight as professional boxers here.
I agree. They both just landed some big left hooks.
Atakishiyev has kind of dominated so far in terms of scoring punches, but certainly Acosta has weathered the storm. It's one of those fights, if you're scoring, you're kind of thinking it's not going to go the distance.
And like I said earlier when I was talking about Juarez out of Mexico, I mean, these guys are in wars every day. This is nothing for him to sit and take a beating. These guys take a beating every day in the gym. They go to war in the gym every day. So, I mean, Zamig cannot get comfortable or get lackluster because this is an everyday occurrence for Acosta. This is what he does every day in the gym, so it's nothing new for him. Mm-hmm.
And as we talked about, Zolt, how many times have we seen heavyweights, no matter what the discrepancy is in record or weight or experience, you can get hit with one shot and down you go.
Look, all it takes is one punch. And if you look at Lennox Lewis, when he fought
Haseem Rockman in South Africa.
Yes, Haseem Rockman.
Douglas, yes. Mike Tyson.
Yes, yes. But especially Lennox, because he ended up fighting him again, and he proved to everybody that it was just a lucky punch. And that could happen in any weight class, to be honest, but more in the heavyweight. And Acosta's still in it. He's still throwing bombs in there. Like I said, he's not tired. This is the third round now. And he's still in it. Zamig is winning. I thought he won every round, but, you know, Acosta's still right there. He's not making it an easy win, an easy fight for Zamig, that's for sure.
Still ahead, the main event, Carlos Nava, undefeated Texan on Texas Takeover Night, is the next fight. But we still have another round to come, and the heavies are going at it here tonight in Brampton. Jorge Sevilla Acosta and Zamig Atakishiyev from Azerbaijan.
Put your head up, relax. You're fighting too much. You don't need to fight with this guy. You're letting him come, you're covering, he's hitting you. Come on. You be first. Stay here. Bang, bang, and move. I don't know why you're letting him go close. Come on.
Back again with Zolt Durrani.
Big off. Here, bang.
Welterweight champion, Steve Molitor. Former champion as well. He knows all about this. One thing I want to ask you about. And you went through this too. Your kids are here. You're a daddy too. How do you balance four kids?
Four kids.
Did you start having kids when you were 12?
I was a busy guy. I started young, and as soon as I had my first child, it changed my motivation. You know, it changed everything. The way I think about things now and just the way I go into the ring. I always go into the ring now. It's like my opponent is trying to take everything away from me. Everything. They're trying to steal the food away from my children. And I'm not letting that happen. I don't care who it is.
I remember a guy who said that a few years ago, too, sitting beside you.
And hey, a small backstory on how this world goes full circle. Rod Black used to call my fights at Casino Rama. Zol Durrani was babysitting my children at the hotel room when I was fighting. That's how this world goes full circle.
I seen Steve Mulder become world champion and defend it multiple times and become two-time world champion. It was amazing, honestly. I'm very grateful that I was able to go through that and just the relationship that we have and all the advice that he's given me and everything. Like, you know, I always seen him work so hard. Low blow over here.
Low blow, fourth round of eight, and Zanig is hurt too. He's gonna get a breather. So the reason I talked about kids is because you were inspired by Molitor.
Yes.
You're inspiring others. That's where the next stage of Canadian boxing has to come. With Red Owl, with Owl's Nest, inspiring the next generation for the next Zol Durrani, the next Steve Molitor, the next Lennox Lewis, the next Donovan Boucher, whoever that might be.
Yes, and you know, it's crazy because when you're a child, I always believed in myself. And just seeing Steve Molitor was able to do it, and we were in the same gym, I was like, I can do it too. So just being able to witness that, and I encourage all the kids, you know, where no matter what you think of yourself, what people say, it doesn't matter. No matter what sport you're in, no matter what you're doing, I just think you need to believe in yourself. Even if people don't believe in you, because I've had people when they stop believing me after that one loss, because I didn't fight for 3 years, I had a close fight, I wasn't myself at all. So after that, I really realized where, you know, who really believes in me, who not. And I've had a lot of people who don't believe in me, but I knew. I told people, I'm still going to be world champion. This little hiccup is going to make me better. That was a nice right hand by both of them.
Speaking of hiccups, Acosta got stung there. He comes forward, and he's still hammering away.
Some good hard shots landed by Zamig.
So after that low blow, I think that fired up Zanig at Atakishiyev. Looked.
I think it gave both of them a little bit of a breather, and they're coming strong because, you know, they got their rest.
I think that Zamig's in great condition, fellas. Mm-hmm. But the big thing that a lot of people at home don't realize or understand, when you have a man who weighs 70 pounds more on you and is leaning on you, grabbing you and leaning your body on you, that will suck the life right out of you. So considering he's had a guy who weighs 70 pounds, if not more in my eyes, leaning on him, dragging him, pulling him down, I mean, the conditioning of Zamig being a heavyweight is still pretty impressive.
And look, I've been sparring heavyweights lately, and like I feel really strong. But I'm telling you, when their bodies and I'm pushing them off of me, it's different.
It's draining.
Different.
It just takes it right from your legs. And two good body shots.
He's trying to say it was low.
Those were two good body shots. I don't know why he let him stop there. And a third.
Another one. And again, Floyd Porter talked about their waistlines earlier, about them being a little bit high at times, so it's very difficult to judge and adjudicate and referee those low blows. That was not low. That was right in the belly.
There were two bangers above the belt line.
And earlier, about a minute ago, Acosta did something real sneaky that I noticed. He used his weight. He pushed Zamig off of him with his shoulder, and then came with the punch. And that was very sneaky and a veteran move by him, so that was impressive.
Final moments, bell sounds, and away we go. And they're still standing, Acosta and Zanig, Atakishiyev. And right now, it looks like it's Atakishiyev's fight. I just don't think this fight's going to go the distance.
Well, again, as long as Zamig Atakishiyev, those body shots are making such a big difference, more than I think he even knows. They're really slowing down and hurting Acosta, so you got to keep working those body shots. Back in the day, if you kill the head, the body will die. Or if you kill the body, the head will die. You just got to keep chipping away at that tree, chopping that tree down. Eventually, it's make it a lot easier as the rounds go on.
And, you know, I think both of them are throwing good body shots, so it's going both ways. I think they're both trying to tire each other out. And, you know, just like right there, both of them body shot. They're body shot, body shot.
You know what the theme is of tonight, guys? These Mexican fighters can take shots.
Yes.
Every Mexican fighter, even despite the result, have been able to hang in, including Acosta.
I fought a lot of Mexicans. My last two fights were against Mexicans. My second last fight, I ended up knocking him out with a body shot, beautifully timed liver shot. Yes. And, you know, a lot of Mexicans, they can take punches to the head, but you have to break them down to the body. Have to.
See if Zanig, Atishikev will do that in round five of eight scheduled. Again, neither of these fighters have done this before. Have gone the distance. Again, they're big, big bodies just leaning on each other now. Kishniev with that big beard. Acosta bearded as well. Here at the Owl's Nest tonight.
It was a big overhand he landed, but Zamig wasn't fazed by it. Ooh, nice left hook.
Shot to the left. Atakishiyev prowling now. Maybe sensing something.
You just got to be a little careful not to follow him without punching. He's got to keep that jab pumping and keep the mind of Acosta busy, because you don't want to just keep walking into a punch where Acosta could lure him in with an overhand right or something silly.
Midway through round five.
And a clash of heads there, and you see Atakishiyev complained to referee Porter, and there was a clash of heads in there.
Hey, what, Acosta's taken a lot of punishment. Still looks pretty fresh.
You know, headbutts, like my last fight, for example, my opponent kept coming in with his head, kept coming in. And after a point, I was just like, listen, do you just want to go headbutt a whole round? Let's just go headbutt a whole round. Because it was crazy, and, you know, you have to watch out for that. In this pro game, you need to be smart. Oh, I think Zamig got hurt to the body just a little bit, fazed him.
Just over 30 seconds, Floyd Porter. Gives him to get back at it. Moments away from a sixth round. It's an area that Acosta has never fought beyond six rounds before, so we'll see how the stamina plays in here. He looks pretty weathered right now.
I feel Zamig needs to use his feints more and just set certain punches up, because he's just coming in and punching, and he's throwing his jab a little bit slow. I would like to see him pop that jab, feint to the body, come up top, because if he was to do that, I think that's how he would catch Acosta. Especially in this later rounds, because they're both slowing down a little bit.
Two big warriors going at it here tonight. Away we go. Still standing to the corners. Some of the action we just saw. There was that clash of the heads you guys chatted about. Well, who's gonna blink here? Zoltan Durrani called him the Mexican Butterbean. Jorge Sevilla Acosta.
And that body shot hurt him right out of the gate. Zamig landed a body shot in between the elbows.
They got a Kishniev trying to stretch his record to 9-2-1.
Nice right hand. Nice Zamig, nice body shot.
And again, complaining about the head.
Zamig's got to focus on the fight, not worry about the referee calling headbutts or whatnot. As a fighter, it's our job to fight. The referee will call what he sees, and if he doesn't call it, we can hear Billy Martin in there already chiming in and doing what needs to be done in regards to the headbutts.
And especially because Zamig was coming in. So, you know, when it's like that, it's a little bit different. But when the fighter is coming at you
with headbutts,
and he keeps coming with head, that's a different game, right? But if he's coming in and they clash heads, he needs to watch out and be careful how he's coming in as well, because Acosta is bringing his head down. with the shoulder roll. The
Some good
shot.
Clean shots have been landing by Zamig at Atakishiyev. And it's just by keeping it simple. The beautiful jab followed by three nice. Beautiful right hands. It's three times he's done that.
Nice
jab, jab, right hand.
Fourth bout of five tonight. Sixth round scheduled, eight in the heavyweight division. This has been a slugfest from the get-go. Zamig Atakishiyev trying to find some finishing touches here to a guy who hasn't gone the distance in the past, Jorge Sevilla Acosta. Here on DAZN tonight, around the world we are, from the Owl's Nest in Brampton, Ontario.
I think Zamig is starting to get tired, and
you never like when you see whether it's a hometown fighter or somebody, you don't like to see him complain to the referee so much and look for help in
there.
It's not a good look for him. So hopefully when he goes back and watches, I'm sure Billy Martin will say, hey, listen, I'll take care of the referee. You just focus on the fight. Don't worry about being a crybaby to the referee. Just focus on the fight.
Agreed.
Red Owl president Gabriel Fanous just going behind us, looking like a proud papa. Loves this event. Five now box fests and growing.
And they've really taken over and really stamped their name here in Ontario and throughout Canada, and now with Houston throughout North America. I mean, these guys are doing big things. They do the right things. They do the right things for the boxers and for the people and the fans. So, I mean, nothing but great things ahead for Red Owl Boxing all throughout North America.
Only going to get better. Again, final few seconds here.
They both landed some big shots a few seconds ago.
Got to think that the judges have it out of Kishniev so far, but I don't think any of us who started watching this fight would think that we would be going to a seventh round.
No, I'm surprised. You know, they're both tiring down. They're both getting a little bit more tired. But I think, you know, I'm impressed by both of them. I'm impressed by both of them. But they definitely need to get their second win, because I see Acosta looking at the clock as well. Looking at
here,
the
here, all night, here, all night. Come on, two rounds of boxing. Two rounds of boxing, you win this, okay?
You see Atakishiyev breathing really, really deep
in there.
Almost deeper than Acosta. Again, just that constant weight coming towards you. You punching that 400 pounds of weight coming towards you, leaning on you. It'll suck the life of you. And he's taking a toll on Atakishiyev. He's still boxing well. Yeah, he's still boxing well, but it's a real drain to have that constant weight walking you down, leaning on you. And it's taking a toll. Yes. But he's done well. He stayed off the ropes, and he hasn't let it bring him down or affect his game plan here tonight.
Credit Jorge Sevilla Acosta for hanging in here against Zamig Atakishiyev.
I like round the jab. Seven. He came out with the more of a pop. I think Billy gave him
said,
some
hey,
good
we gotta start letting your hands go here. Start popping those shots. He's ready to go.
Acosta just kind of reminds you of a defensive lineman in the National Football League, doesn't he? He's got that same kind of stature.
Looks like referee Floyd Poitier's going to take a point here for a possible headbutt or give him a third and final warning.
Very firm warning. Very firm.
A lot of movement with that head. Zamig's been complaining.
And I think that's fair. I think it's fair to warn him one last time just like that.
Atakishiyev looking for his ninth win. And fought around the world, hails from Azerbaijan. Flurry.
I like what I'm seeing this round.
Atakishiyev's boxing well, but again, just the size and just the... When you, and again, I said this earlier to Rod Zolt, and you know as well as I do, when you're sparring in gyms in Mexico, this is what they do every day. They go to war. This is nothing new for him.
Yep.
What a war this is tonight, guys. Acosta got hit with 5-10 bell shots there.
I feel like if Kishniev just comes a little bit forward, but smart forward, and lets his hands go, and does smart pressure, I think that he can stop Acosta, because Acosta's, he's looking almost like looking for a way out. You just need to give it to him.
And Kishniev will land a beautiful left hook like that to the body and then take three or four steps back.
Yes.
and when he should just stay on him and keep that constant pressure, not only physically, but mentally on Acosta.
Final minute, round seven. Kishniev looks fresher for sure. Landed more punches for sure. Has been more dominant for sure, but Acosta.
He still has, like, again, they just have it. That's what they do down there. They spar 15, 12 rounds at every level. That's what they do is spar and go to war with bigger guys, smaller guys.
Acosta still.
Got some pop in his shots.
Yeah, got some pop there. Looks like we might be destined for an eighth round. This is
the uncharted,
uncharted territory for Jorge Sevilla Acosta. Has never gone this distance before. Still hanging in. Zamig out of Tishnikov trying to finish this off. And it's going to go to an eighth round. What a scrap this has been.
Definitely the surprise of the night. But hats off to both men, Roddy. I mean, Akishnev's still been, he's still throwing a lot of hard shots against a big, heavy target that just keeps coming forward and leaning on you. And hats off to Acosta because he's still in this fight. And he'll still throw a shot here and there to remind Akishnev, like, hey, this isn't really over just quite yet.
Jorge Sevilla Acosta. A record of 5-5-2. The big, big dude. And again, he knows what it's like to fight in Canada. Last two fights have been against Edmonton native James Cernak. Looking to get a win here.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the eighth and final round.
I think the surprise of the night is we're into the eighth round.
It is, but no surprise in the scorecards, Rod. You mean Akishnev has won every round. He's boxed well from the outside, used that jab, landed a lot of hard overhand rights, good shots to the body. Overall, he's boxed a perfect fight tonight. It's just such a big target to take out, but we'll see if he can do that here in the eighth and final round.
Oh, a couple of big shots, both sides. And Akishnev took a shot too, but how did Acosta absorb that one?
Two big right hands.
Again, this is a place that Acosta has never been. An eighth round.
You know what I'm really surprised about as well is Acosta's face. He's been taking some big shots, and he doesn't look like he's been in a war, you know? He's a little bit of swelling going on there, but I'm surprised.
These are some heavy shots coming from Mathusan. As he pushes for the knockout, you can hear Coach Billy Martin saying, let your hands go and dig. And he's doing just that.
It's like a big, big boulder. Acosta.
Both landed a big shot there.
Midway through.
What a chin.
Acosta just landed another big right hand.
The eighth and final round. Acosta hanging around and hanging around. Looking to pull an upset here.
Nice body shot.
Acosta's hands down. Boy, these two guys have run a marathon here tonight.
Just a minute left in this final round.
You're right, Zolt. Acosta's expression has not changed one bit the entire night.
And though Zamig Ateshnev may have not have get the knockout he wants here tonight, these are good, good rounds of experience that you get with a crafty Mexican. This is experience that you can't pay for. This will level up his career as he moves forward, getting these good rounds in under the hot lights, under the pressure, and the power of Acosta is keeping Akeshinev honest.
He's only gone eight rounds once before, and you're right, just going the distance sometimes, getting that game shape, knowing what you have to do.
Digging deep for that eighth and final round when you've never been there before, crossing that border, I mean, it's a good thing for his career moving forward, that's for sure.
Well, and a great, yeah.
And a great showing for Acosta. I mean, he could have found a way out of this fight many, many rounds ago, but he kept throwing, kept trying again. I mean, it was a great fight for heavyweights in there and a great performance by Zamig Atakishiyev. He boxed well from the outside, threw good body shots, and that was a great performance overall. So hats off to him and Coach Billy Martin.
Let's hear it for the big boys, though. Yes. That was fun, that one. Boy, I would not want to get hit by either man at any time, Mike.
That is for sure, Mr. Black.
When you are ringside and you can just, you can feel the shots.
And the thud.
And I always say it, but that's why I'm wearing a black shirt. You're very smart. I don't know what happened to Molina. The sweat and the blood are getting on a white shirt.
I'm used to it. I'm used to it.
But how about that? These guys were lumberers,
yeah.
They were throwers, and I'll tell you what, tonight they were scrappers and fighters, and they were survivors.
And they earned the respect of everyone here at the Owls Nest of Brampton, Ontario. They both put on a great performance, so hats off to both gentlemen. But an easy one for the judges, Rod, in my eyes, to call this one. Should be a clean sweep across the board. 8-0 for our man, Zamig Atakishiyev.
Guy who started fighting 20 years ago, started as a kickboxer, and then got into fighting. And he got turned on and loves the sport. He's a lifer, 37, he's the oldest fighter here tonight. And he fights like a much younger, you know, he looks a little
Ladies and gentlemen, after 8 rounds of heavyweight action, we go to the scorecards, and our three judges at ringside see the bout unanimously, all three scoring it 80-72. To your winner by unanimous decision, Zamig Atakishiyev.
Including Judge C. Molitor and Judge Sol Durrani, Zamig Atakishiyev. Full value for a big win in the big boy battle tonight.
I mean, it was a great performance. I mean, a lot tougher, I'm sure, than him and his team expected. But that's the sort of rounds that are only going to progress his career. At such an old age, Rod, you got to, fast track your career and pursue your career as fast as you can to get better as fast as you can. So this is a great fight at this stage of his life and this stage of his career. So a great fight for him.
Yeah, for a guy, again, 37 years young, and Zamig is standing by with George Nasios.
Here with your winner, Zamig Atakishiyev. My Russian's not too good, so we got your first match winner, Nawid Zaman, to translate for us. Zamig, a big man in there. Went the distance, 8 rounds. Was it tough fighting a man that big?
Как это было? Было очень тяжело. Спасибо о том, что кто меня поддерживал. Всем спасибо, мой тренер Билли. Он очень помогал мне. И мой менеджер Гарри Фридман. Спасибо всем.
Thanks to everyone. He was a heavy guy. He could take punches. But yeah, thanks to Billy, Coach Billy. Thanks to all the team.
Now, your last two matches, you were 8-0-1 and you suffered 2 losses your last 2 fights. How good does it feel to get back in the win column?
Начинаю тренироваться. Буду еще сильно. Будем всем выигрывать.
I'm training hard right now, and then right now I'm getting better, obviously. And yeah, we're going from here on to get more wins.
Now, looked like it got you a couple low blows there. Did that motivate you or inspire you to come out and attack again?
Мне очень тяжелый удар попал. Вниз попал. Ну, больно было. Я выступал, не ожидал. Больше не ждал.
It was a heavy punch under, but he could take it, it was a problem.
Congratulations on your victory, Zamig Atakishiyev.
Спасибо всем.
Congratulations. Zamig came up big in Brampton tonight at the Owl's Nest with Steve Molitor, Zol Durrani, getting ready for the main event. And I've seen the main event fighter, the Texan, Carlos Nava. He's undefeated. I think you're in for a treat. I know people watching down in Texas. Speaking of Texas, how about Owl's Nest South as Red Owl goes south to Houston, Texas?
I think one of the main things that we talked about too is, does this solve a problem?
Yeah.
Boxing, I don't think anyone, No one has went over and beyond and gave fighters a consistent schedule to fight on for as long as we're talking about doing it. That fighters, trainers, and managers all alike are going to fall in love with that piece right there. So as we flesh this thing out and we turn it from concept to reality, I think a lot of heads are going to turn and people are just going to be naturally drawn to it because it's consistent.
As if we use Houston as a case study and prove that it can work there with new incentive structure, new organizational structure, consistency in fights, everybody cooperating together, we wanna structure it the same way that every other sport operates. That's it, you know? There's no magic sauce. It's just like, let's build this better.
Building the dream in Brampton and Ontario and building it in Texas. Congratulations to Red Owl and President Gabe Fanous. And here we go, main event tonight. Carlos Nava from Pasadena, Texas, against another Mexican fighter tonight, Armando Ramirez Almanza. Almanza, 8-2-1. Carlos Nava is 10-0, undefeated. It's Texas takeover night as we talk Houston and Texas and Canada. And here's our ring announcer, Dave Needman.
Ladies and gentlemen, the stage is set for the final fight of the night. Now making his way down to the ring, a warm welcome please for Armando Almanza.
Mi nombre es Armando Ramirez Almanza. Yo vivo en Celaya, Guanajuato, México. Empecé por un hobby, ¿no? Como todo chiquillo, ¿no? Como todo adolescente. Y pues fui poco a poco aprendiendo y sabiendo más de este bello deporte. Y pues ahora estoy disfrutando de lo que es parte de mi vida. Yo creo que toda la parte, ¿no? Tanto física como los sparring son lo que más me gusta, ¿no? Siempre me gusta estar haciendo sparring casi diario. Creo que es algo de lo que más me gusta como boxeador. Pues una gran pelea, ¿no? Yo creo que es una noche muy, muy agradable para el equipo mexicano que venimos esta velada boxística a Canadá. Esperen una gran pelea, no una guerra. Yo vengo a hacer mi trabajo, entrené perfectamente bien y a dejarle un buen espectáculo a la gente, que es lo que se merece.
Well, the Mexican parade continues here in Brampton tonight. Armando Ramirez Almanza, his first fight ever in Canada. This fight is scheduled for 8 rounds, a distance he has gone 4 of his last 6 fights. Don't know much about Almanza. We know more about our headliner tonight. But one thing, the theme of the night has been, guys, Mexicans.
They come to Mexico, they come to fight.
They come to fight.
Yes. They take a lot of pride, Rod, you know what I mean, back from the days of the great Julio Cesar Chavez and all the other Mexican legends along the way, Marco Antonio Barrero, Eric Morales, and the list goes on and on and on. These guys come here to fight, these guys come here to win. No matter their record, no matter who their opponent, they are here to fight. So I'm really
excited
for this main event.
And now, set to make his walk to the squared circle, please welcome Carlos Nava.
My name is Carlos Nava, and I'm from Houston, Texas, 25 years old. I'm 10-0 right now. I'll say my pops got me into boxing. He just, you know, put me into a gym, and we just started liking it, and I started competing and just been great at it. I had won a gold medal at 14-15 at Nationals, which was, I was ranked number one on the whole USA. After that, I got bronze. I guess everything's bigger in Texas, you know? It's like, we have a lot of great fighters out there. You know, there's Regis, Charlo Brothers, you know, you got Foster. There's a lot of great boxers out there, you know, a lot of talent, and Texas is starting to be big for boxing now. I'm gonna come out explosive, you know. I'm gonna box, like I'm gonna like, that's my main thing, I like to box. You know, hit, don't get hit, my feet work. I'm gonna show them the skills, you know. Skills pay the bills, but eventually I'm gonna walk them down and I'm gonna take them out.
Well, howdy, partner. Here he is, Pasadena, Texas's Carlos Nava. First time ever at the Red Owl Performance Center. that a Canadian, a non-Canadian headliner is here. And a lot of tonight is the theme of Texas guys and what Red Owl has done going down to Houston and having a successful bout down there and card. And here Carlos Nava, what we are hearing, what we are seeing, is he's a rising star.
He's got a lot of talent. I've seen him fight and I've done my homework on him. He's got a lot of talent and a very bright future. But tonight, he's got to get the job done and worry about tonight before he thinks about the future. In the sport of boxing, you're only as good as your last fight. So I'm looking forward to a good performance with him. And we can see as Red Owl and the rest of the team moving forward in his career with the new house down in Houston.
Coming off a unanimous decision last month in Houston over Candacene. He's a young pro, Zolt 10 fights in 2 years. But it is interesting. You know, it's free trade now. Canada, United States are great neighbors. If you're watching in Houston tonight, down at the Red Owl Center there, they know about Carlos Nava. Mm-hmm. Let's go to David Needman.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the Owl's Nest here in Brampton, Ontario, Red Owl Boxing and DAZN proudly present the featured bout of the evening, scheduled for 8 rounds or less in the junior welterweight division. This bout is sponsored by Remy Martin Cognac, sanctioned by the Ontario Athletic Commission, Commissioner at Ringside, Luke Kotick. Your timekeeper for the contest is Jim Monkelbon. And the three judges scoring the bout at ringside, Martin Dalida, Jasper Kujawski, and Jeremy Hayes. And once the bell rings, the third man in the ring, Donovan Boucher. And now, for everyone here in attendance and those watching at home, the moment of truth has arrived. We are at the Owl's Nest and live on DAZN, and the time for talk is over. Here it is, your main event of the evening. Introducing first, on my left, fighting out of the blue corner and tonight wearing blue trimmed with gold. He weighed in officially at 138.5 pounds. He enters the ring with a professional record consisting of 8 wins against 2 defeats, 3 wins coming by way of knockout. Hailing from Celaya, Mexico, ladies and gentlemen, damas y caballeros, presentando Armando, el Chico Almanza. And his opponent on my right, fighting out of the red corner and tonight wearing neon green. He weighed in officially at 142 pounds even. He has an unblemished professional record. 10 fights, 10 wins with no defeats or draws, 6 wins coming by way of knockout. Fighting out of and representing Pasadena, Texas, USA. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Carlos Nava. Once again, referee Donovan Boucher.
Both of them got some cool hairdos.
Yes. Yep. Good fades for this one. Barbers have been busy. Got some nice dye working. Zolt, I think, you know what? You said, you know, it's all about the look. What are you thinking?
Listen, I'm still the best looking. It's an easy win.
Looking forward to this junior welterweight.
Okay, gentlemen, I'm expecting a good, clean fight. Listen to my command at all time. Most importantly, protect yourself at all time. Anything here is good. Anything here is good. Gentlemen, touch gloves, and good luck to both of you.
And I just don't know. If people are scared of me because I'm too good-looking, they're scared that their girlfriend or their wife is going to think I'm too good-looking, or is it because of my boxing? I don't know.
Don't they know that you're a proud papa? Yeah, come on, eh?
Yeah, but you know these jealous guys. You know how they are.
Okay, here we go. Main event tonight, what we've been waiting for. Texas against Mexico. Carlos Nava. Tell you one thing, this is the most colorful fight of the night. If we lose power, we're going to be able to see them. Nava wearing the fluorescent trunks. And
Almanza from the South Pole stands, popping that jab and moving to his right early, setting the tone on how he wants his fight to go. He wants to be moving away from the left hand of Carlos Nava.
Nava, Pasadena, Texas, undefeated. in our main event here tonight on DAZN, wherever you're watching around the world. Very active early on, both fighters. Not much traded so far.
I really feel like Almanza is really throwing some mustard behind his shot, trying to send a message early to Carlos Nava.
Nava, quick jab there. Almanza, 8-2-1, has suffered two losses. Nava wants to keep his record unblemished here in Canada. Texas-themed night on Boxfest 5.
I really feel like Carlos Nava is trying to kind of get a range and get a guess in the timing of Almanza, because Almanza is just so fidgety coming in, shaking and weaving. You know what I mean? It's hard to get a gauge on the timing. So Nava just got to take his time and stand the outside like he's doing there.
Very much a feel him out. Both fighters doing a lot of weaving here. Final minute, round one. Scheduled 8. Nava sticking out his tongue here.
Ooh, nice left hook by Nava.
Bounces off the ropes. Very much a feel them out first round.
But that's the sort of round and that's the sort of fight that Armando Almanza is going to want. He's going to want things to be not nice and smooth. He's going to want them to be fidgety and awkward. Carlos Navas got to find his range and slowly just kind of start touching him and backing him in the corners and finding his range and finding his momentum in there. And that's going to happen through a first few rounds of just the feel out process for a smart boxer like Carlos Nava.
Ramirez did a good job. He's not trying to allow Nava to come forward and throw him a lot of punches. That was just the first round. So let's see if he can keep this pace up and try to let his hands go even more later on.
And that's what Almanza's got to do. He's just got to stay on top of Carlos Nava. Because you give a guy like Carlos Nava too much time to move and think and box, he's really going to start to pick you apart. So Almanza just got to keep up that pressure and not give Nava a chance to think and create a game plan as the fight goes on.
Armando Ramirez Almanza, Mexico, with that red dyed top, and Carlos Nava gone blonde for this fight. See what round two presents here tonight in Brampton.
I think some nice counter shots will keep Ramirez at bay, right? And I think Nava's trying to set him up for that, but he's still finding his range with it.
Exactly, Zolti. He just got to keep pumping that jab, and he just slowly down him in for those counter shots.
Misses and a duck there from Nava. Both fighters around the same age. Very closely matched in our tail of the tape. Oh. Trading now here near the ropes.
And this is the sort of fight that Almanza wants it to be when he has Nava backed up and on the ropes and blocking shots.
Nava seems to be the aggressor here in this middle part of the second round, coming forward quite a bit.
Ooh.
Big overhand by Nava.
Ramirez comes right back.
Ramirez, Almanza, content to be the chaser here, boys.
And I think that he knows, even during the first round, he found out that Carlos Nava is a very good boxer, and Almanza doesn't have the boxing skills to stand there and box with him. He has no choice but to come and fight with Carlos Nava, and that's what he's trying to do. And Nava's got to keep working behind that jab and spin off those ropes and start countering with some hard shots.
Nava again on the prowl. Wide haymakers that he's throwing.
No, Ramirez, Armando Ramirez has a good game plan. I think he's trying his best, and he's really coming forward and just throwing body shots. He's trying to break Nava down because Nava's a good boxer. He's a good mover. So Ramirez is trying the right things. You know, now it's just after round, I'm just curious to see what Nava's going to do to slow Ramirez down, because he's going to have to slow Ramirez down because Ramirez keeps coming. And just like how Steve Mulder said for my fight, you know, it's tiring when a guy just keeps coming forward. It is draining and tiring.
Definitely been on his heels so far, Carlos Nava. You're right, we'll see what happens in this next round to see if the tact changes. Let's get to the corner now. There's Ramirez, Almanza. We'll hear what both sides have to say. So far, a very good test for Carlos Nava. Armando Ramirez Almanza has come all the way from Mexico to Canada to try to take down a Texan. Round three. To the ropes, he does it again. Has him in the corner, and that's a hard body shot. Kind of missed that time.
Looks like Nava's looking for a counter. His corner was telling him to punch right back as well.
There's really no answers right now for the aggression of Almanza. Nava just kind of waiting strategically to find an opening, it seems.
And he's going to have to start countering, because the last thing you want to do to a guy like Almanza is start giving him confidence where he can just walk you down and throw how he feels. There's got to start to be receipts and consequences coming from Carlos Nava to Almanza. Say, hey, you're not going to walk me down and bully me around.
Agreed.
Almanza, not sure how much he knows of Nava and Nava of Almanza. I tell you what, Almanza's game plan is quite simple so far. He wants to win this fight.
He wants to win, and he wants to exactly fight. Carlos Nava, on the other hand, he's trying to box his way to a victory, where Almanza, I think, he's just willing to grind it out and be a little tougher and be a little more aggressive. But a good counter shot from Carlos Nava as he spun off the ropes in the corner.
Nava's really been on his heels so far. That's because Almanza's been coming forward. It's tough to do for eight rounds, though.
And that's exactly what I was about to say, Rod. You know, early in my career, you know I give away the first two or three rounds as a feel-out process in a championship fight. This is only an eight-rounder, so, you know what I mean, if you're down three rounds or down two now, you have to secure the next rounds handedly or not even have a close round. So, you know, I really feel that Carlos Nava's really going to start to be decisive in landing these shots and making Almanza miss with his.
And Steve Molitor, you had some great conditioning. You had the best conditioning, best stamina I think I've ever seen.
Yeah.
I'll take that.
Well, you were babysitting his kids. I saw him front row, and I was watching that. Strategically, it was brilliant, and your conditioning was par excellence. Now Nava coming back so far in this fight. We're not judges, but you'd have to think the Mexican has the edge so far.
It's very close. I mean, there's been some good boxing, some good movement by Nava, but yes, you mean, for here in Ontario, you mean the judging, you mean, it's not as consistent as a place like Las Vegas or Montreal due to the lack of activity. So these judges don't always, for me, see the clear boxing. They see the activity, the aggression. So, I mean, it could very well be two or three rounds, nothing for Almanza after the first three rounds. But Nava is boxing well. He is, I mean, shifting and moving well. He's got to just be a little more decisive and really stop Almanza, because he's letting Almanza just walk forward with no receipt, no answer. He's just letting him come forward with no sort of consequence.
With former two-time IBF super bantamweight champion Steve Molitor and WBO global welterweight champion Sol Durrani, Rod Black with you on DAZN tonight in Brampton at the Owl's Nest. Here we go to round four of eight. Carlos Nava has come from deep in the heart of Texas into the Owl's Nest tonight, and he's facing a hawk.
And you can tell Nava has all the skills. He has all the right moves. He has everything. But I just feel that he's going to start letting his hands go and really start showing these judges that, hey, I'm not only the better mover and angler, I can throw good punches and combinations.
And it could be two reasons why someone doesn't do it. One is because they're watching their stamina, they're watching their conditioning for later rounds, or because the power, right?
He respects the power.
Yes, so it could be a little bit of both, but, you know, I'm curious to see. Right now he's throwing some nice counters.
See if this tide turns, which has seemingly favored the Mexican so far, who's been the aggressor, but certainly has not stung Nava a bit. Carlos Nava is in supreme physical condition. Here comes that boxing skill you talked about, Steve Molitor.
And he's landed some good shots here in this round from the outside. Good, clean counter shots on the outside here in round number four. So we're seeing a lot better stuff from Carlos Nava here in this round. Some good, hard counter shots.
Trying to run away from that push off again. Nava seems to have more bounce in this round, too.
Yeah.
He does. Bounce in his feet, quick reactions, hard shots. It's been a very good round for Carlos Nava.
Ramirez does not want to lose this round. He's really coming forward after he got hit with those punches.
Carlos Nava backing up the first three rounds, going forward this round. There's a wild right and a left, and another right from the American. This corner really urging him on. Get some energy, they say.
And this is good pressure from Armando Almanza. Even though he's not always throwing punches, but he's constantly walking forward and just tracking down Carlos Nava. And as a defensive fighter, that's threatening, and that makes your heart pound. You're constantly thinking, you're constantly under stress.
Nava doing a good job ducking in and out of some of these close encounters near the ropes. It's kind of like being in the eye of a tornado, somebody coming at you like this the whole time.
Or it'd be like being attacked by a pit bull, just nonstop.
Yes. That's what it's been so far. Nava hasn't had a moment to breathe. Another bell here. That was a better round for Carlos Nava.
It was a better round for Carlos Nava, but very tough for the judges to score. But good work by Nava. I felt like he landed a lot of clean, hard counter shots in that round. He was a lot more elusive with his defense, but still, the constant pressure from Armando Almanza has just been unweathered.
Nava let his hands go more this round.
He only good when he gets close to you and you sit on the rope, then play close.
He let his hand go even more because Nava let his hand go. So
turn to
it is a competitive fight.
But let the combinations go, okay?
As we thought about at the beginning of this fight.
Here's
how they come in, very close in age. Nava with the height, bit of a reach advantage, and certainly the big advantage. Unblemished 10-0.
Yeah, and you know, Armando, he's never been knocked out. The two losses he has, he lost against, you know, pretty good fighters. He only has 3 knockouts out of 8 fights, but you know he has some pop here, and he definitely came in shape for this fight.
To the second half here, halfway through, scheduled 8. If we go 8, Nava now, he's looking a little PO'd, isn't he?
So this is a really good test for Nava over here, and you know he's gonna have to come out strong these next 4 rounds.
We've had a couple of mini flurries, but we really haven't seen any rock'em sock'em so far from these two fighters. It might start to change here in this 5th round.
There hasn't been a decisive shift either way in the opening 4 rounds. It's going to be a tough fight for the judges to score, in my opinion. I think Armando Almanza is doing a lot of good work, but I mean, Carlos Nava is still hitting with clean counter shots. So it all depends on what these judges are scoring.
Yes.
But there's still 4 rounds up for grabs.
I like that quick right hand that Nava throws, catches Armando.
Oh, and a good body shot.
Big body shot.
And this is right where Armando Almanza wants his fight to be, tough and rough on the inside, throwing those hard shots. And that's a bad place for Carlos Nava because he's a good, slick boxer. Yes. You see him try to scoot off the ropes there.
And the clinch, a little shot to the head, too. Donovan Boucher is the referee, will break them up here. Past the midway point of round number 5. Junior welterweight. Carlos Nava undefeated, now starting to trade them. Ramirez Almanza has not stopped. He's been on his toes, fighting forward the entire fight.
He hasn't taken too many backward steps tonight, that's for sure, Rod.
And he doesn't look like he's going to. The only way is if he gets hurt with a body shot or a headshot. That's the only way I see Armando backing up, not coming forward the way he is.
El Chica is his name. As Steve said, he's a pit bull.
Let's go, hurt the champ, Carlos.
Nava. He's trying to figure this out. Tell you what, he's running out of rounds. He's better figure it out soon. Very defensive fight, though, for Carlos Nava.
And he really has no choice. I mean, he's not slipping or stepping away to throw a good hard counter shot to stop the. Oh, and
nice
a good right
hand.
But it didn't slow Almanza down 1 millimeter.
Not one.
Let's get to the corner. Let's hear from Carlos Nava's corner right now. What is the strategy moving forward?
I'm the corner of Carlos Nava. You gotta tell these, I mean, it's a close fight. You gotta start letting your hands go because the judges are, for me, in my opinion anyway, they want to see Armando Almanza put Nava on the rope and just throw shots. As we see here, I mean, there's a little bit of a spin off by Nava, but the story of the fight for me, I've seen Almanza have Nava on the ropes just bombing away.
Yeah. Nava really needs to switch it, and he's a good boxer, he's a skillful boxer. I think he just needs to, you know, step a little bit more forward, not go so much on the ropes. He's on the ropes too much, and the judges do, they like that for, you know, your opponent, Armando.
Yeah.
So he needs to get off the ropes, he needs to pop
box
that jab
in the center
more
of the ring.
Yes. And he needs to use his feints and start, you know, making Armando think about what he's actually doing, not just because he's just coming forward, he don't care. So he needs to just like that. I like that uppercut. It just missed, but the idea Nava has, I like it.
Well, again, great experience for Nava, just a still a very young fighter, only a couple of years into the pro game, but undefeated. If he wants to keep it undefeated, though, he's going to have to start figuring this out here in these final three rounds. He has to win these rounds to even make it close, you would think, because he has been so defensive. Almanza hasn't scored with a lot of punches. But he's been the bit better fighter.
He's a better, cleaner boxer, yes, but the volume of punches, the intensity is definitely coming from Armando Almanza, as he hasn't taken a backward step all night.
And that seems to be the tact. Carlos Nava, who fought Boxfest Red Owl in Houston recently, stretching his record to 10-0. He fights a lot, will be fighting a lot. Both you, Zolt and Stevie, these kind of fights early in your career are so beneficial, no matter the outcome.
Yes,
you want to become a champion.
Yes, and I see Nava, this fight over here, he's learned so much. No matter what the outcome is, you can tell that he's getting comfortable in there now. He's getting more and more comfortable. And no matter what the outcome is, you can tell that after this fight, he's going to be way more comfortable, and he's going to be a better fighter from this fight.
And like you said, Rod, these are fights, especially at this point of your career, these are fights that you learn and you grow from that will develop you into a world champion. You need these tough nights and these rough nights against these sort of opponents to become a world champion.
Getting close to the midway point of round 6 of 8.
You know what I noticed this round is Nava is not on the ropes as much. And I did hear his corner tell him, get out of there, get out of there. So he is trying to get off the ropes more now, which is a good thing.
But the pressure has not stopped from Armando Ramirez Almanza. Every chance he gets to trap Carlos Nava on those ropes and bang to the head and the body, he's doing just that. And whether they're landing their clean or clear or not, the judges are counting that as scoring blows.
Neither fighter tonight has really been hurt in this bout so far. I'll tell you what, both are tireless fighters. It's taken a lot on Nava, too. He's trying to slip out of some of these clinches and run around like this. Here we go again. We go to round 7. And Armando Ramirez Almanza is taking it to Carlos Nava, the favorite in this fight. Let's get to his corner.
So either hook or you throw again. Let your fucking hands go, man. I see you work your goddamn hands. Get out there and whoop this damn dude. You're better damn boxing him. You sitting there wrestling with him. Fuck wrestling with him. Get it out there, box his ass. Let your hands go. Come on, man. We gotta get the fucking win. You work too damn hard for this dude. Come on, let the combination go.
Here we see Almanza. The story of the night, he's just had Nava's rope backs to the rope the whole night, landing not even clean shots, but just throwing shots. And in my opinion, Joel, I mean, that's what's gonna give the judges a reason to give him the round and give him a victory.
Yes, and Nava's landing some nice counter punches in there, but it's hard to see.
And they're singulars, and they're one at a time, and they're nice counter shots. Yes. And he's a great boxer, but the volume is coming from Almanza.
And it's hard to see, like from even where we're sitting, it's hard to see that he's landing these counter punches because it's one at a time, like you said. And Armando is throwing. Even if he's getting hit, he's still throwing, so it doesn't look like he's getting hit. So on the judges, it's not the best look, especially throwing it off the ropes.
Yeah. You got 2 rounds to do it. You might be having to look at stopping this fight somehow because Carlos Nava, guys, he might have won on the judges' minds, maybe 2 rounds here so far.
Yeah, it's tough. Again, I'm not sure what these judges are scoring. I mean, they might like the aggressor, the clean, slick boxer like I was back in my day, but I think my job is a lot cleaner and slicker than this.
You weren't backing up as much either.
But you never know what these judges are scoring, so I still think it's on the table, but he's really going to have to get a knockdown or really put a beating on Almanza.
Almanza has not slowed down from the outset. He has been going forward. He's tireless. It's like the Energizer Bunny in there.
And I just don't think Nava has the power to put him in his tracks or to check him or make him think twice about walking forward the way he is.
Nava just has no answers right now. Halfway through the seventh round, scheduled eight here in Brampton tonight. Carlos Nava's undefeated streak is in serious jeopardy.
Oh, a beautiful right hook. Caught Nava, but credit to Nava, he took that like a champion.
That might have been the first.
He needs to get off the ropes, Nava.
That was the first one that really stung somebody, and another left there. Carlos Nava is taking a beating in this round now.
And Nava landed a nice right hand in that corner, but again, it's hard to see because it's a one shot, and Ramirez keeps coming.
Well, it hasn't been a good night for Mexican fighters in results. They've all gone the distance. But this one might be different. Oof. If Armando Ramirez Almanza.
He got hit with the big left hook there. He's
his nose or something.
Oh, yeah, something's wrong with his eyes. He's...
Yes, he is. Carlos
Nava. And that was in the clinch, And that's lack of experience. That's lack of, you know, not defending himself properly because he's thinking that he's not going to get hit. And like we were saying earlier, this fight, he's learning so much from this fight, no matter what the outcome is. You got to protect yourself at all times. Even if your opponent is holding you, he can throw a random punch, just like Armando did.
Well, when he needed to win a round or stop him, he didn't get it. And it's going to come down to a final round. And it looks like Carlos Nava is going to need a knockout.
I don't claim to be a professional judge, but definitely I think that's what's going to have to happen if he wants to get the victory here tonight. I know that Carlos Nava is here as a hometown guy. You got to let it go. But we have to give credit to Armando Almanza, who fought hard.
He can't outbox.
He's even
standing up as we go into the eighth and final round here. I mean, he's hungry to win.
And he's confident. After that last round, he's confident. So he wants to come out here and he wants to try to stop Nava, to not leave it to the judges. I can tell the way he's standing there and the way he said he doesn't even want water, he's ready to go. It shows me that he really wants this and he's trying to go for the knockout.
Ladies and gentlemen, round of applause. This is the eighth and final round.
Well, here we go.
I think this round Nava needs to be smart, but be strong.
Oh, he's got to go for broke in my book, Zolti.
Yeah.
Well, he needs a knockdown, a knockout, or something to pull the scorecards even close in my eyes.
Well, here's the thing. He's coming out strong here, and he needed to do that in, you know,
four or five rounds ago,
and it's maybe left this way too late.
And it's not for lack of skills, because believe me, I've watched Carlos Nava fight before, and I'm watching him here live. He has all the skills and tools to be a great, great fighter. I just think the constant pressure of Armando Almanza has really put a chink in the armor of Carlos Nava, where he's gonna have to learn how to deal with a fighter like this who comes forward, and that comes with experiences like nights like tonight.
Nava did land a nice right hand off the ropes.
Took a left there.
Armando keeps coming.
You know, if the strategy was to kind of wait this guy out, that strategy didn't work.
No.
Because this guy has not stopped.
And at this level, that should never be a strat. Oh, and nice uppercut on the way in.
Just caught him.
Caught him under the chin.
Navas staggered here. And look at the bounce now from the Mexican fighter.
Some good work by Carlos Nava here.
Armando Ramirez Almanza doing everything possible to spoil the Texas night in Brampton tonight.
Nava has more power in the middle of the ring when he's not on the ropes. When he's on the ropes, there's not so much power that comes from his punches because
he doesn't have the
leverage.
And the leverage that he has with that long reach. And a guy like Armando Almanza, that's where he's comfortable. He wants to fight on the inside. Mm-hmm. He's comfortable. That's what he's been doing for the past 2 months. So he wants to do that here tonight.
Final minute, Nava needs to go for broke here. And he's already been stung a couple times in this round. You're right, the leverage, the power's not there. I'm not sure he could knock him out even if he had a clean shot.
And the energy level of Armando Almanza, he's came here prepared tonight. He's done his homework, he's done his training because he's been going forward and taking shots and giving shots all night long.
You know, you talk chess matches. This is a perfectly played boxing match from the Mexican fighter, from the opening bell.
It was. He stuck to his game plan. He came forward. He threw shots to the head and the body.
Final few seconds.
Both exchanging nice punches.
Unless the judges see it completely differently, and there's an upset in the cards.
Last 15 seconds.
This is going to be an upset tonight on Texas night. Carlos Nava's win streak.
Could be over.
Could be over right here and right now. Nothing, how about the pit bull?
Nothing guaranteed in boxing, but I thought that was a great performance by Armando Almanza. He stuck to his game plan. He did what he could do best, and that is keep a guy like Carlos Nava on the ropes and not give him a chance to get comfortable, get warmed out, where he could possibly box Almanza on the outside and go to a victory. He did what he wanted to do in there, and that should get him the victory here tonight.
Unless, again, there's a decision that we did not see, but you never know in boxing, right? You've seen it before.
Yeah. I've seen worse things happen.
Yeah, Carlos Nava, make no mistake. He's got the skill. He's got the potential. He is a terrific boxer. He's got talent. He's going to learn from this, Salt. He's going to have to learn from this if he wants to move further.
Yes, and I think this is a great experience for him. This is a great learning experience that Nava did here. And I believe if he does not get the decision, even if he does get the decision, I think that if they were to fight again, I think Nava would do better because he's learned so much from this fight.
He wouldn't wait as long, that's for sure.
Yes, yes.
I think definitely when he looks back, he's going to understand that. You mean you can't just give away, especially in an eight-round fight. You cannot be giving away the first three rounds because then you got to sweep the rest.
Yeah.
But that's what boxing is about. It's about learning and growing. I didn't always have the best fights or the best nights. Zold, nor have you. This is what we do as champions. We learn and we grow. But let's let it, we're going to have to go to the official scorecards to see if that's what's happening here tonight.
Well, it was supposed to be a Texas takeover, a Texas two-step or Texas hold'em, but it looks like it's going to be a Mexican win unless it goes the other way somehow, some way. But Armando Ramirez Almanza, to these eyes, in the very least, sitting ringside, looked like the better fighter here tonight.
I wouldn't say the cleaner, better fighter, but the more volume, he should win the score.
Ladies and gentlemen, after eight rounds of boxing, we go to the scorecards. Judge at ringside, Jasper Kujawski, scores the bout 78-74 for Almanza. Overruled by Martin Dalida and Jeremy Hayes, who both have the bout 76-76. This bout has been declared a majority draw.
Wow, your jaw's just dropped. Okay. Well, again, it's a judge sport, as we know, and we've seen stuff happen before. Stranger stuff. There is Almanza Ramirez, or Armando Ramirez Almanza's wife. You can hear the crowd's displeasure.
The crowd knows who won this fight. Yeah. I'm sure both men know who won this fight, but nonetheless, it was a good night of boxing for the Red Owl family here in Brampton, Ontario.
Well, George Nassios is in the ring. He's standing by with Carlos Nava. Let's see what Carlos had to say after this one.
We're here with Carlos Nava. Carlos, that was a really tough fight. Did he give you more than you expected?
No, I don't even think he hit me. Hit my arms, hit my back of my head. I don't think he hit me.
So do you think you won the fight?
Of course. I thought I won the fight.
What was it like fighting here for the first time in the Red Owl? I know you fought in the Red Owl in Houston. What was it like fighting in Red Owl in Brampton?
It was cool, you know, like Canada's cool. You know, thank you for inviting me over here. It was awesome.
He was constantly on the attack. Were you expecting that? Did your plan go according to what you wanted, or did he throw you off that he was constantly on the attack?
No, I expected him to come at me, but I mean, he didn't hit nothing, you know? I was just tight D, hit my arms, you know? So I don't know what they were watching.
All right, congratulations. Thank you for coming out.
Yes, sir, thank you.
Well, Carlos Nava is still undefeated. Not sure what we just saw. I know what we thought we saw. Zoltarani's with us, Steve Molitor, in our final few moments of what was another great night, though, of action here tonight. Five bouts and certainly a controversial decision, Stevie, and that final one. Hey, so you both have seen that before. I know the crowd didn't like it. I think Carlos Nava liked it. But I think when Carlos Nava looks at the tape and his group look at the tape, they know that they're gonna have to be better next time.
They're gonna have to be better. They got the boxing gods helped them out tonight. He got the draw. There's no blemish on his undefeated record. Moving forward, that may not happen in an eight-round fight. I think the biggest lesson that he's gonna learn here tonight is that you cannot be giving away the first three rounds in an eight-round fight, and you cannot let somebody smother you without hitting with a clean counter shot and just sit on the ropes. A good night of boxing from start to finish. I mean, when the Medzaman versus Juarez in the opening fight, as we see some highlights here from Mahindas, he boxed so well tonight. The strength and conditioning that he's been going under on the show tonight, because his opponent was a bigger, stronger man, but in the end, Mahindas showed that his strength is taking place and he's going to be a force to be reckoned with here on the Canadian boxing scene.
And he wasn't backing up so much. He wasn't on the ropes. You know, he was standing his ground. And his boxing
looked a lot cleaner, Zolti. The last few times I've seen him fight, you know, he's a little wiry. He's really tightened it up a lot.
More comfortable. I think he's more comfortable in the rings because of the power.
Tell you what, the heavies might have stolen the show tonight.
By surprise, by going eight rounds, that stole the show for me, that those guys went toe-to-toe for eight rounds. They threw nothing but hard shots, every shot, and the toughness and will and determination of both men, and a great performance by both men, because you don't see big guys sit there and throw so many shots. They threw a lot of shots in there tonight.
And listen, I said it from the beginning. I called him the Mexican Butterbean for a reason. I just knew he's going to come out here and he's going to throw some bombs. That's what he did. But Zamig did a great job. His European style, he kept the Mexican Butterbean at bay.
And then the guys with the dyed hair went at it. And again, they're going to be talking about this one, a controversial decision. Again, we're not judges. And you know, they're looking at scoring. They're looking at boxing, ultimately. And, you know, it is boxing, and they judge boxing. But you guys have watched a lot of fighting and boxing before. And to others, I'm sure, it looked like the Mexican fighter prevailed.
He definitely, in my eyes, won that fight. It wasn't just the pressure and the punches he was throwing. It was the ring generalship, the control of the ring. He controlled mostly everything in that ring tonight. But hats off to Nava. He still fought well. He has room for improvement. He will be back and he will be better. And this would be a learning experience. When he looks back on this tape, he's going to learn a lot from this fight.
Zolta, so I want to ask you, maybe take it from the advocate of being a judge and what they might have been looking for in that fight and why they would have seen that Carlos Nava. Again, he was on the retreat a lot, but that doesn't mean you lose a fight if you're on the retreat.
Yeah, so, you know, I look at it and I don't mind this, and the reason why is maybe Ramirez Armando did win. You know, maybe he did slightly. It was a close fight. Maybe he did win in my eyes. But look, Nava is an upcoming fighter. He's 10-0. You know, he is the better fighter. But he just tonight he just didn't let his hands go enough. And I think that this is a great learning experience for him. And I think this is a blessing. You know, this is a blessing for him. And yes, I'd like to thank everybody for watching and joining in on the zone.
Okay, before you go though, Zolt, tell the world you need a fight.
I need a fight. Listen, guys, don't be too scared. I know I'm good looking, but come on, it's just a boxing match.
Hey, let's drop some names here. Ron Lawton, the zone live. Zolt, who would you like to, at this point in your career, who would you like to step in there with?
Everybody in the top five, anybody in the top 10. I want anybody. You know, I want big fights. I'm here to prove to everybody that what I'm capable of. And I believe in me. I believe I'm going to be world champion. And it's a matter of time. You know, I know that I'm a big risk, but don't be too scared. That's all I'm saying.
Hey, you did a terrific job tonight. Great being with you, champ and champ.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It was a lot of fun being here at Red Owl Performance Center for Boxfest 5. They're going to be talking about this for a long time, I'm sure, until the next Boxfest.
Yes, sir.
6. And which should be not too far down the road. So for Zoltarani and Steve Molitor, George Nassios, our entire crew, this is Rod Black. Good night, everybody, from the Owl's Nest in Brampton and Boxfest 5.